What, are you kidding me? Devils up 3-0. Game 4 of the Stanley Cup Finals on Fox. That cup's getting closer from the Garden on its way to the Garden State. Because tonight, the Devils are looking to do the unthinkable. Sweep the Wings for their first ever Stanley Cup. I feel that cup coming now. Detroit was unstoppable, a finely tuned machine running at all cylinders until the lightning of Lemieux, the thunder of the crash line, and the bricks of Brodeur's wall turned Detroit's wings red with nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. Summer break may be coming a few games early for Professor Bowman, who definitely taught former student Jacques Lemaire too much. The Devils prefer decaf, and a D has neutralized the Wings' top guns. They're going to have to fight fire with fire to fly out of this one, because that cup's crossing the river to the Jersey side. Hey, have you ever danced with the Devil in the pale moonlight? Anyway, listen, this cup's got a hot day with the Devils, unless the Wings can do what has only been done once before.
We're the Devils! The Devils!
Jersey fans are expecting the Devils to sweep the Red Wings and in the process capture the franchise's first ever Stanley Cup. And it's a sellout crowd inside of Brendan Byrne Arena, anxious to see if the Devils will become the first New Jersey team to win a championship in its home state, or if the Red Wings will finally solve the Devils' riddle. And good evening, everyone. I'm James Brown, along with my partner, Dave Maloney, and it has been a surprising postseason run by the New Jersey Devils. They were not the marquee team coming into this series, but they have snatched that spotlight.
Well, you know, JB, I played for Fred Shiro, coached two Stanley Cup winners for the Philadelphia Flyers. He suggested the game was simple. You take the shortest route to the puck and arrive in ill humor. This series has been totally dominated by a bigger, more physical New Jersey Devil hockey team. And boy, we're going to take a look at some right here, JB. This is Billy Garrett. I'm Paul Coffey. Welcome to Devil Hockey. The hit of the series, Scott Stevens on Kozlov. There's been no ice for the Red Wings. As a result, whack, you go down, Sean Burr, and here's Peluso on Burr again, and we're going to see Lemieux in front. Devil Hockey, they take the ice away, whack, 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 and that, ladies and gentlemen, has resulted in the fact that shots per game for the Detroit Red Wings are just about half what they were before. Goals for the Red Wings, half again. No first period goals, and finally, they're 0-3 in the Stanley Cup Finals.
The Devils have not only taken ice away from the Red Wings, they've also stifled an awful lot of talent on that team. Who are you most disappointed with as far as the Red Wings are concerned?
Well, I think if we agree with the fact that the ice has been cut in half for the Red Wings, Paul Coffey is a guy that has to be more creative for the offense of the Detroit Red Wings to work. He has not been that factor. He was against Chicago, hasn't been yet. The Red Wings are in a big hole, JB.
Well, Paul Coffey has an awful lot of company in terms of being disappointing as far as the Red Wings are concerned, and we've got some extra eyes on the ice who are also going to tell you why the Red Wings have not played so well. Right now, let's take you down ringside to our reporter, Joe Micheletti.
Okay, JB, thanks very much. Now, only two teams in the National Hockey League scored more goals than the Detroit Red Wings in the regular season. And yet Detroit, in the playoffs, have only lost three games in the first three rounds. But it's been the defensive style of the New Jersey Devils that have really given Detroit problems. They've been very frustrated.
I think everybody's embarrassed on our hockey club. We didn't want to be down 3-0 like this. And there's still a lot of fight left on this Detroit team.
Even when you make a good showing, they don't even say you're the second best. You know, they have to remember that what they do in the finals is going to be a big focal point there throughout the rest of the summer and for years to come. And we can't leave a taste in our mouth the way that we did after game three, and the fact that, you know, we are here because we did a lot of good things.
Now, the New Jersey Devils have been low-key and very businesslike throughout the course of the playoffs. In fact, Claude Lemieux was mentioning this morning, they're not as excited as they are focused for game number four. Now let's send it upstairs to the men that will have the call, Mike Emmerich and John Davidson.
Well, John, Scotty Bowman, the winningest coach in hockey, was the most troubled after game three. You just heard him a little bit. That was light compared to the blistering that he gave his team. What do you think the aftermath will be?
Well, those are cold, hard facts, Mike. Their team's down 3-0. They have not played well. They've only scored one even strength goal in the first three games of this series. Accept the challenge is what he's trying to tell his players, and he wants Fedorov and Coffey and Vernon and the rest of the players to play better. He's inserting some bigger players in the game for this one tonight against the Devils. He's changing their style of play. They need to get it going now, and he has issued the challenge to his players.
Well, in this electric atmosphere, they're already chanting, "We want the cup." What'll it take to get the party started for New Jersey tonight?
Well, I think the Devils, they don't want to change anything. Every team they played in the playoffs have had to adjust their system and style of play to play the Devils. And tonight, Detroit is doing exactly the same thing. I think if the jitters that may bother the Devils early, they want to get that out of their system, not change anything, and continue to play the way they play.
If the Stanley Cup is presented tonight, right after that, the Conn Smythe Trophy will be presented to the player judged most valuable to his team in the playoffs. You have some nominees?
Absolutely. The Devils have been so good in the playoffs, you can look at each and every position. Brodeur in goal. Stevens on the blue line as a defenseman, and up front, maybe the favorite, and Lemieux, who has scored big goals all the way through. Add to that mix their head coach, Jacques Lemaire. They've had some run, folks.
Two pieces of hardware to be presented tonight, but then again, maybe none. JB?
All right, Mike Emmerich and John Davidson, and the opening faceoff is just moments away. The question for the evening is, will Detroit get it done and force a game four back in the Motor City? Or will the Devils take game four and win their first Stanley Cup? The answer comes over the next three periods of play. It's the Stanley Cup playoffs right here on Fox.
Steen wins to get the Stanley Cup. The guys who play inside here have 15. Game four of the Stanley Cup Finals. 19,040 fans are here. The Red Wings and the Devils from the Meadowlands Arena. The guys that wear the 30 pounds of equipment, the goalies. Martin Brodeur. He leads the league in average, in wins, in save percentage, in shutouts, and another marvelous number, he's only 23 years old. The Red Wings' survival rests with the man who helped get them to the finals. 32-year-old Mike Vernon pulled during game three. Back tonight for this must-win. Three men with 53 years of NHL experience are in charge of this game. Bill McCreary, Wayne Bonney, and Ray Scapinello, who is skating in his 300th playoff game. That's a record. Kerry Frazier and Kevin Collins, the standbys, and the off-ice officials are from the New York Rangers.
Head coach for Detroit, Scotty Bowman, he will be making some changes. Bigger players in the lineup. He's going to be rotating three centermen, all with different wingers, and he wants a more passive game in the neutral zone. He's going to try to create turnovers, so Detroit is changing their style against Jacques Lemaire. His team had a great practice this morning. Detroit did not skate this morning. Jacques Lemaire's team, very businesslike. Their locker room, very cooperative, very quiet. And they didn't say anything wrong. They didn't do anything out of the ordinary. Just your basic game day for the Devils as they try to win their first ever cup.
Game 81 of these playoffs. 2 months ago, anyone who accurately could forecast tonight's scenario could have only been using a dartboard. And the fans here have just, they've only seen their team play at home now. This will be the ninth time in 2 months' time. I mean, they're used to seeing so many more games in 2 months than this. But boy, it hasn't dimmed their enthusiasm. This afternoon, they showed up. Many of them were in the parking lot this morning when I got here around 10:30. But it grew and grew. There was tailgating and cookouts and all of the other sorts of things that you see as the precursor to a party.
It was a barbecue feast out there. Man, it was great just to walk through. Put on weight walking through. It's fun here in New Jersey as they get ready. I think we have to watch more for what Detroit does as they try to adjust their game to the Devils' game, change their lineups. For instance, starting right now, Primo and Fedorov, two centermen, starting on the same line to begin the game.
With Darren McCarty as the other winger, Paul Coffey and Bob Rouse are the defensemen. Scott Stevens and Sean Chambers, the defense for New Jersey. They started McLean, Carpenter, and Claude Lemieux.
Scott Stevens will be on the ice, as he has been throughout the series, as much as possible when Fedorov is on the ice. Primo starts at center ice for Detroit. In the previous game, he played with an abdominal problem. He had it frozen before the game. The freezing wore off as the game moved along, and he wasn't nearly as effective. But big Keith Primo wearing number 55, there you see him. He said for tonight's game, he felt better, so he didn't need to visit the doctor prior to the game.
Scott Stevens lifts it in, and here's Lemieux, the first one to it. And it's swung away from him by the big goal stick of Mike Vernon. And so Carpenter retreats to play it. So what you were saying about Detroit's style of play tonight sounds a lot more like New Jersey.
Exactly. There's a couple of things to watch for Detroit. They feel that their defense has been just battered. Paul Coffey in particular, he's been hit a lot. So they're changing the pairings of their defensemen. Coffey will not play with Lidstrom. He's going to play with Bob Rouse, if at all possible. The Devils have done a lot of forecheck, skating into the Detroit zone unstopped. They don't even have to go through people, just moving in and have battered and battered and battered these defensemen for Detroit. So Detroit's going to try and hold them up, not forecheck as much, and maybe try to win a very low-scoring game.
Well, that's a radical departure from what Detroit has done to get here.
Oh, to get here, the thought was you can't trap what you can't catch. Well, Detroit hasn't been able to skate through these people, so they're trying to adjust.
Neil Broughton, but offside. Puck must be ahead of the attacking team over the blue line, as you see the summary of this series so far. Claude Lemieux with a key goal in game one. Final score was 2-1 in favor of New Jersey. Scott Niedermeyer with one for all the video highlight reels. Two shots, the second one in, 4-2. And then Claude Lemieux with a scorcher on Mike Vernon. At that time, it was 2-0. It wound up 5-2 New Jersey. So they go for a sweep. And Detroit tries to prevent it and send a game back to Detroit. Game five of the best of seven would be on Monday. Ken Danico matched up with Bruce Driver, two guys who've been with this team since the fall of 1983. Richie moving in. Stefan Richie, center, ricochet off front, they score!
The Devils broke through the neutral zone, the place where Detroit was trying to slow them down. Everybody drove to the net, but did it go off a skate? Was it directed in on purpose? I'm sure it will be checked upstairs on the video replay. You see here, Richie on a different line, playing with Broughton, moves in. The puck goes to the front. Broughton is there, and somehow the puck squeezes underneath the right leg of Mike Vernon. First shot on goal, first scoring chance for New Jersey, and it finds its way in behind Mike Vernon. Now here's Richie breaking into the zone. Ramsey's down. Broughton's in front. Does it go off of him, or does it go off the Red Wing player in the goal crease who is down? That's Bob Airey, number 21. Is it directed in off a skate? Does it go in accidentally? The decision will be made upstairs as to whether the goal will stand or not. Another look at it. There you see Broughton. It goes off the stick of Broughton and through. Can't quite tell. I don't know if it ever made contact with Broughton. I think that will be a goal that will be allowed by what we've been able to see.
Video replay has been used 18 times in the prior 80 games of this playoff year. You see the seven occasions in which it is used. One, of course, is to correct the clock, which does not deal with a question of goal or no goal. The rest do. And
this
now we wait.
May have a real effect on Detroit if this is a goal that's allowed to stand by New Jersey, as again, New Jersey will get the lead. And there you see the puck. The question is it directed in on purpose off of Broughton and his skate? Does it hit his skate? He was in the crease, yes, but the puck was already there, so that makes that part of it legal. And it does slide underneath the skate and pad of Mike Vernon. Well, this is a tough call. It has to be a conclusive call. If it's not conclusive, it will be a goal. This Broughton's already touched it with his stick. Mike,
well,
I don't
tough.
Know. It is real tough.
Broughton's skate was behind the pad from that angle, and yeah. So he couldn't see if it made contact.
Yeah, the first time it touched Broughton's blade of his stick, went between his own legs into Vernon. But how did it get in the second time? I think it's a goal, yes. That's a great play by Broughton and a great play by Richey, who was a right winger, went over to the left side of the ice and got the puck, drove into the zone, and it's 1-0 in New Jersey.
Neil Broughton, late season acquisition from the Dallas Stars, has now gotten a point in each of the last five games, sixth goal of the playoffs. When he got here, they had thoughts of a second defensive centerman, and the bonus is that he has just brought John McLean on his right side to life.
When they were thinking about making a deal to try and acquire somebody for the stretch run, the thought was, let's get somebody like Bobby Carpenter. Bobby Carpenter's played so well defensively. Let's get somebody else to help him so he doesn't get tired. So they brought in Neil Broughton from Dallas, and as you mentioned, Mike, he's been just super defensively, yet he's added so much offensively that he's been just a pure bonus for this club. Scotty Bowman had a talk with Bill McCurry, the referee, and was told exactly why the goal was allowed to stand. It's 1-0 New Jersey.
Broughton from Richey and Chorsky. And you see how the points are spread about throughout the playoffs. The Devils have used 24 players, two of them goaltenders. Martin Brodeur even has a point and assist. Chris Terreri, the backup, did not. And the other is Danton Cole, who has just played a little bit in one game. Keith Primo took the hit from Stevens.
Mike, the big boys for Detroit trying to play against this big crash line that is dominated physically for New Jersey.
One of the Red Wings was just put into the photographer's box on a hit, I believe, by Randy McKay.
You know one reason why that happens in this building, and you see it a lot. The boards here are 41 3/4 inches high. In Joe Louis Arena in Detroit, they're 48 inches high. A big difference. That's the reason why you always see players get hit, and the leg drive of McKay throws them right into the bench where the photographers were, but they're shorter boards here. You see it happen. The reason, Mike? They got another row of seats in this building down near the ice surface, and at the ice surface, the seats slid back gradually. So they had to lower the board so everybody could see.
Krzelniski and McKay are both fine and are both still out there. Krzelniski 18 in red, McKay 21 in white. Shuttle shot by McCarty was deflected away, driven back around by Sean Chambers. It is Bobby Holik headmanning on to McKay. McKay met at the line by Slava Batisov. And a centering pass, and Holik sent one wide. Krzelniski on him, and boy, what a hit attempt by Keith Primo. This is a guy playing hurt. But what a courageous athlete, Keith Primo. Here is Batisov rolling it around. Krzelniski given a bump by Stevens. Stevens shaken by that. Krzelniski lost his stick and his shot. They score! Detroit has tied the game. Fedorov, and it's 1-1.
Yeah, the big boys on the ice to match the big boys of New Jersey. And they changed a little quicker. Peluso was still on the ice for the Devils and overskated the puck in behind the goal. Fedorov came off the bench, went to the net, got the rebound. Look at 2-on-2 in the corner. There's Peluso over on the right side going behind the net. He thinks somebody else is going to get the puck. He leaves it. Fedorov shot, save, rebound underneath, and we're tied up at one. Scotty Bowman wanted big players against the big players for New Jersey, and what a fiery shift that was. Both teams were just banging, and Detroit gets their second even strength goal of the series. That's all, both by Fedorov. Good point play by LaPointe there. He missed the check of Peluso. Fedorov got in front. We're tied up and one.
When Detroit did not wilt, the decision came down that they were behind 1-0, and right out they came. Big hit attempt by Primo. He didn't get all of the guy that he wanted, but big hit attempt, and then back they come, more crunching. Krzelniski really got Scott Stevens.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think the shift was set up with a hard play of Primo, and players follow leadership, and leadership is being shown by Primo, and Detroit is back in the game. Of course, they're only down by one, but the penalty, you think maybe that was a crusher giving up the first goal early. But they've come back.
Fedorov missed for Kozlov. It's taken by Tommy Albelin, Swedish-born defenseman, rolling one along. That's handled by Paul Coffey. Bob Rouse. No goals by the defense of Detroit in this series. That was not the case against Chicago. Offside.
Pushing, a little shoving. Rouse on the ice after suffering a concussion in the last game. And he's paired with Paul Coffey. The Detroit Red Wings don't want Coffey hit in this game. Look at Primo, 55 red, explode here. Bang! what a hit that was with Peluso. He has not been able to explode like that since this series began. There's Richie showing some strength on Coffey along the boards. That's what Detroit wants their team to stay away from. Coffey getting hit. Bill Guerin for New Jersey has hit Coffey more times in this series. See what Rouse is doing? Right over to Richie, giving him a message. Coffey gets hit, we're going to try and do something about it. Coffey, if he gets hit a lot, he's not effective. If he has some freedom to express his skill level on the ice, he's awesome.
Well, Coffey has said that the real value in the playoffs is not having been 10 or 11 or 12 years in the league, but going through wards. And you can do that whether you're a rookie or whether you're a longtime veteran. Well, this has started out as a war tonight.
Oh, it sure has. You're going to see Detroit, too, really juggle their lines up. Again, two centermen on the ice, Primo and Draper. Draper goes off, so they get their matchup. Here comes Big Scoot Grimson. He's against Billy Guerin. Guerin's done more hitting than any other devil on Paul Coffey in this series. So the Detroit Red Wings really trying to change on the fly, really trying to adjust to this tough game the Devils play.
Just under 3 minutes having been played in the first period, and already two goals, Rotten and Fedorov. Rotten for New Jersey, Fedorov for Detroit. Taken by Doug Brown, former New Jersey Devil. Brown now accelerates with a pass on over to Nicklas Lidström. Flings it back in off the big goal stick of Martin Brodeur. Alvaline slowed it. Freeland tucked a pass on over to Bill Guerin. Guerin bringing it on along with Brian Ralston. Guerin to Niedermeyer, and a shot is blocked by Fetisov. Slava Fetisov, the ex-Devil, trying to play it along. On second effort, he controls and lays it back out. Doug Brown playing it there, trying for Primo, but it kicked on back to Fetisov. Three shots for the Red Wings, one shot for the Devils, and that was the goal. On Brodeur, and skied back. Fetisov to take it there. Dumped back along, and it'll be handled by Neil Broughton. Broughton hooked off by Iserman, and it's played on over to Driver. Circle to circle for Niedermeyer. Now Driver. Devils wind it through. Chorsky can't get that. Konstantinov can. Cicerelli moved to it. Back to the point. Driver, a shot blocked down in front. Injured on that play was Fetisov, and he is limping to the bench. Gets cranked right back in by Airy. Brodeur can't stop. Cicerelli cross-bodied by Driver. Down behind Airy. Hit hard by Danico. Cicerelli digging for it too. Bob Airy trying to pull away. Driver sees the loose one and punches it to the corner. Eiserman dueling with Chorsky, and Chorsky ahead. Picks up Neil Broughton, but it'll be a two-on-two. Chorsky a shot, and that deflected into the seats and play stopped. 15:26 to go in the first period. 1-1 and a tough one.
We've seen some hitting and some good hitting, and 55 Reds in on most of it. Here's Guerin going to the bench for a line change. Primo got in the way, and then the linesman does a nice job separating them. A face rake or two. Those gloves are rough on the inside. The fans enjoyed that in behind McLean and Cicerelli.
The hits are 11 total, 9 for New Jersey and 2 for Detroit. Scott Stevens up with this. One of the hits was by Krusielniski on him, and he was shaken from it, but he hasn't missed a shift and is out there right now. Bobby Holik double-teamed. Swept it ahead again, hoping for McKay. And it's played out by Lidstrom. On the Detroit scoring play, it was Lapointe and Fetisov assisting on Fedorov's goal at 2:03.
Again, some members of the crash line out there, Holik and McKay. Peluso misses a shift. Now, I wonder if Jacques Lemaire, who's very hard on his players, decided to sit Peluso for a shift after the goal that was scored by Detroit, where he missed his assignment in the corner. Detroit scored. Peluso sits. It happens that quick. So the crash line, who's been so good in the playoffs, gets separated for a shift.
Mike Peluso's family is here from Minnesota. Randy McKay's here from Canada watching this game tonight. Don't think it might have been the collision that occurred between him and Primo, do you?
No, I don't think so. I just think Jacques Lemaire, when he sees things happen out there where it's a mistake or a mental mistake, I mean, he makes quick changes, real quick changes. Now here you see the puck about to be dropped. Bobby Carpenter's line on the ice. He can't take the drop. He's had troubles with a wrist. So Wadlemieux goes against Big Keith Primo, who's had probably more ice time than any other Red Wing.
Scott Niedermeyer emerges with it for New Jersey. Off of Primo. Wheeled back in by Carpenter. Hardy went down trying to hit Carpenter. Puck dumped back along. Good hit on Stu Grimson by Carpenter. Ahead comes Primo. Trying to get by Niedermeyer. On the wing. Shuttle shot is stopped. by Martin Brodeur from McCarty's stick. It is Lemieux. Oh, and he had Richey driving, but he couldn't get the pass to him. Primo trying to fight his way by Niedermeyer. Taken on now by Tommy Albelin and shuffled back in. Chip change on for New Jersey as Rouse goes back to play.
A lot more life with the Red Wings here in this game. Every rush up ice, the players are standing up on the bench. They seem to have accepted the Scotty Bowman challenge of being embarrassed by the Devils in Game 3, and they were embarrassed.
Off of Chorsky. Chorsky trying to recover. Coffey on him. Nino Cicerelli and McKay. And eventually it's tied up for a stoppage of play. 13:59 to go in the first. 5-1 Detroit in shots on goal. Scotty Bowman said something happened in our locker room between games 2 and 3. Well, something has happened somewhere. They haven't practiced between games 3 and 4, but you can tell it's a different team.
2 days of practices missed. Detroit's game plan to this point is working. The Devils have only had one shot on goal. They scored on it on that jam play involving Richey and Broughton. But I think even the one-on-one battles that we've seen so far, Detroit seems to be doing better for a change. I mean, the Devils will never be out of a game. They just play such a strong system. Detroit, in this one, they've shown much more than what they've shown in previous games. They're into it. They're into it with a little more passion.
Danico hit, rolls it around. It comes to Tom Chorsky. Bennett for McClain, but the shot blocked down by Constantino.
They've also blocked a lot of shots. At least 4 shots already blocked by Detroit's defense.
Iserman flipped one that's brushed aside by Bruce Driver and taken by Broughton for the chip back out.
In fact, I think Kutisov is now missing his shift because of that shot that he blocked his last shift when he got hit on the left ankle.
Good point. Iserman sent down by Danico. Gets back up again as Broughton tries to play it through. 3 Red Wings on him, and Iserman knocked it free. Danico matched up with Driver, Guerin, Broughton, and Ralston, the front line for New Jersey right now. Iserman comes to the bench, so it's Cicerelli and Krusilniski out for Detroit, along with Fedorov, and we get a stoppage of play.
Mike, you notice the New Jersey Hockey Club, it's a club that can wear you down. The longer the series, the better chance they have. They just wear you down, wear you down. They're all big. Larry Robinson, who's an assistant coach to Jacques Lemaire, when we played against them, when he played for Montreal way back in 1980, he was a foot and a half, it seemed like, taller than any other player on the ice, and a great defenseman. I watched him call the entire team together before practice this morning, and he was maybe a couple inches taller than any of the players on the ice. It tells you how big the game has become and how big New Jersey is. Now, here in this period, New Jersey's not been able to forecheck and crunch and bang and batter the Detroit defensemen so far. We're only 7 minutes in, of course.
This is Coffey handing it across. A pass on now for Sergei Fedorov. Fedorov heels off and flings one in front that's shrugged down by Sean Chambers. Battle for it on, and it's quips to Stefan Richey. Back up now with Lemieux, and he tucks a pass across that Lemieux doesn't get. Instead, it's Lidstrom and right back. Fedorov bringing it on. Trickles one that's eaten up by Brodeur and plays up. Bobery down a little earlier than he thought. Olive branches waved for right now. 6 shots for Detroit, 1 for New Jersey in this tie.
One thing Detroit wanted to do in this game, too, is go to the net. They are with their shots. Now watch Bobery and Cicerelli, who can be very agitating type forwards, drive into Brodeur, who held his ground nicely. During the television timeout, Fetisov, the defenseman, got onto the ice and skated around. Here's some more of that action in front of Brodeur. See how strong he is. Took care of Bobery, didn't he, in a hurry? Here's Fetisov. He skated around, tested the ankle, skating around in circles, frontwards, backwards, and then went off to the bench. I think he's about to come back and play, though.
Coffey shot, grabbed by Brodeur. The crash line is out for New Jersey against that of Primo and Cicerelli, as well as Chris Draper, who took that faceoff.
And Peluso back on the left side for the big line. See Scotty Bowman on the stoppage now, puts on some big forwards to go against the crash line. Out comes Grimson. Primo's out there. The point's out there. So what does Jacques Lemaire do? He makes a little change back on the blue line, but we've got a lot of big forwards on the ice right now. There could be a minor earthquake about to happen here.
Do you think we're re-entering a new era, an era that we visited 20 years ago of huge players?
Huge players, but a lot more skilled, like big players. If New Jersey and their system win the Stanley Cup, it'll force teams to become bigger.
Patisse off with a shot that is controlled by Primo, and he got the glass with a shot that was just over the crossbar. The jostling continues. Alvelin locking up with Primo. Bobby Holik able to muscle it around for a play to be made by Niedermeyer. Niedermeyer back to Holik. And Holik cranks a shot wide. No matter, offside.
Offside, the linesmen jump in quickly to separate Peluso and Lapointe. Jersey winning, or pardon me, Detroit winning faceoffs now in the New Jersey zone. Primo has had a good start to the game for Detroit. He's winning faceoffs. He said he was very uncomfortable in game three trying to take faceoffs because of that abdominal injury. The question is whether or not he'll be able to sustain 60 minutes of this type of action where he's being involved, he's playing a lot, he's trying to play physical against a big player like Holik or McKay or Peluso or Scott Stevens, whoever he's on the ice against.
That was an embarrassing stat we just saw, but boy, Primo showed me a lot in game three being hurt. He competed.
I think he's the leader on this hockey club right now amongst
the
forwards.
Yeah.
If he plays well and can play for the whole game, if he's healthy enough, his teammates will follow.
Alvelin cranks it in. Bobby Holik steps to it. Back to McKay. McKay wanting to turn by Patisov. Centered one. Oh, and Peluso got a shot away as he was tripped and flying through the air. Now it's Patisov bringing it on for Detroit. Gives over to Big Stu Grimson for a shot. That tipped into the seats.
What a play by McKay for New Jersey. Their second good scoring chance in the period. Only their second shot on goal. McKay makes the pass to Peluso, who was held up by number 20 Lapointe. Yet with his great reach, Peluso was able to find the puck, and Vernon moved across just standing up and made the nice save. McKay beat Patisov on the outside and then was able to make that beautiful pass across to Peluso. So the big line, the crash line for New Jersey, has a good shift, getting just their second shot on goal of the period. Detroit's had seven to this point.
The Devils first started play here in 1982, moving from Denver. See the captain, Steve Yzerman. One of the guys you just saw, Ken Danico, was a part of the team in the second year. Steve Yzerman and Sean Burr, not scratched tonight, have been together in Detroit since 1985. Yzerman predated Burr by a year. Rouse with a shot that's deflected wide. There are three guys who played for New Jersey for the last dozen years. Yzerman with a shot. That one popped high in the air. Down to the ice went Brodeur. Now it's McCarty up with it. Turning with it is Kozlov. Slava Kozlov with a shot. Deflected in front, but picked up now by Broughton. Played for John McClain, who's able to step by Kozlov. Trickles it back in. Detroit with seven shots out of the nine that have been taken in this game. So what Scotty Bowman came up with has been working, and working solidly.
It has so far. I'm really admiring the play of Bob Rouse to this point, too. The defenseman number three for Detroit. Out with a concussion early in the first period of game three of this series, yet he's right back two nights later. Just fighting along and battling away. There's McCarty in front. He's pushed from behind by Danico. And Brodeur actually tripped up and lost an edge there, more on his own than anything else. McCarty's outside the goal crease. Now Brodeur catches his left edge on the ice surface of his skate blade and fell down. Brodeur here has Yzerman to worry about as Detroit's really trying to go to the net. There's great defensive zone coverage. Three red jerseys and three white jerseys all over them. The shot never got through.
Here's Danico. Shooting one, blocked away by Vernon. Might have been tipped by Breland. Kept alive by Driver. Twisting with it is Mike Ramsey. Ramsey's pass is on to Fedorov, and Fedorov cranks it back in. This will be icing if New Jersey gets there first. They do, so it is.
That was a nice forced play by New Jersey. As Detroit broke out of their zone, they had nowhere to go with the puck. Fedorov had it, and he ends up icing the puck. So it's faceoff in the Detroit zone. The last faceoff in the Detroit zone, they won the draw. New Jersey didn't got the shot. Now here you see Detroit moving out of the zone. They're all on one side of the ice. New Jersey will force them over there. Now, if we stop it, you see here three different players on this side of center ice. Fedorov has got nowhere to go with the puck and ends up icing it.
Nicholas Lidstrom up with this one. Now they're setting it up again, John. Ralston once more, but then it's lost back to Ramsey. And now Fedorov. Boy, it's just smothering, isn't it? Sent back in by Ralston, who was walled by Fedorov. Vernon sets it up now for Ramsey. Mike Ramsey wrapped it around. Mike Krushelnicki took it there. Krushelnicki's pass is tipped on back by Guerin. Scott Stevens, captain of the Devils, controlling. Nearing the halfway point of the first period of this one-all tie. Randy McKay slams it back in. It's Kutisov driving it off. Krushelnicki rushed. Puck played along by Sean Chambers. Battled for and outletted by Fedorov onto Doug Brown. Lays it over for Kutisov. Follow-up comes from Fedorov. Sergei Fedorov wanting to get by. Has to turn away. The Devils take over. Avi Holik headmans it onto McKay. Randy McKay out of Michigan Tech, twisting with it. McKay shovels one, and it's spiked to the glass by Mike Vernon. Some heavy hitting. McCarty emerges with a pass that's tipped, but rushed on by Keith Primo. Crimson and neutral ice, and now it's brought on by Peluso. The big men are getting a lot of ice time.
Against one another. Both teams, big men on the ice at the same time.
Flip back out for Primo to play. Jammed it on back for Kutisov. Slava Kutisov just curls back with it. Bob Rouse plops it. Niedermeyer there. Bob Airey rushed him, but it's played back up to John McClain. Headmans a pass on to Broughton, and they rule an offside.
And we have
and
a penalty
is coming up. The Red Wings protest. They'll be shorthanded in this 1-1 tie.
There's a hooking penalty coming up to Bob Airey. You see Broughton trying to break in. What's strange about the penalty is it happened at the time of the whistle for the offside. Detroit's hockey club very upset that when the whistle sounded, the foul was at that time, and McCreary still made the call. Scotty Bowman was right up at the front of the bench trying to get Bill McCreary's attention. The fans now really into it here, as the Devils with four shots so far have not had any sustained offense. Maybe their power play could give that to them.
Power play is 3-for-11 in the series for New Jersey. Rouse shoots it back down. The point men, once New Jersey gets it set, will be Driver on the left side and Niedermeyer on the right. Up front they go with Bill Guerin and John McClain, 12 and 15, and Sergei Breland, rookie center out of Moscow, number 18. Driver hacks it back around. Mike Vernon slowed it, cleared along by Coffey. Fed over for Primo. If they hurry, it's a 3-on-2. Rouse just tucks it back in. And a change in lines for the shorthanded Detroit Red Wings. Coffey stays out, joined now by Konstantinov. Brown and Fedorov killing off the penalty. Guerin flipped it in front, but it's taken by Sergei Fedorov and sped right back down. 45 seconds gone on the Devils' power play. Scott Niedermeyer lays it over for Stepan Richer. Richer hit by Ramsey.
Aggressive, even in the neutral zone for Detroit. As soon as Richer tried to get skating, Ramsey was right up in his face as Detroit's really trying to hold their blue line.
McKay over to Richer. Fires, and a save made by Vernon. Rebound in front. The net dislodged behind.
What a rocket by Richer. A man by the name of Claude Ruel used to be an assistant coach up in Montreal. And was it intimidating for a young player to go and watch them practice on the day of a game? Because all he did was pass the puck hard to his players and tell them to shoot the puck hard. Shoot the puck harder. Even harder than that. Watch Richer. He was a Montreal Canadian then. That shot hit Mike Vernon's left pad, who played the angle beautifully. Went down because of a partial screen. But one of the reasons why Richer and Lemieux could shoot the puck like this. I mean, hard and accurate. Richer always seems to hit the net. Lemieux certainly has in the playoffs. And they shoot it hard, and they shoot it harder. And to be in Montreal at that time and watch them go through those drills, and you were an opposition player, you were intimidated watching them practice, believe me, especially as an ex-goaltender saying it.
Well, those two guys are the only two current New Jersey Devils who have a Stanley Cup ring, and they got it in 1986 in Montreal and went through a lot of those drills from Claude Royal. Chambers with a shot that's blocked away by Primo, and Primo makes them go back.
Claude is retired up in Montreal, has had problems with a heart condition. But to this day, these players remember those practices and how much it's improved their game. Jacques Lemaire was a player then. Larry Robinson wasn't. Can they shoot it?
Offside called against New Jersey.
again, Detroit, this is the most aggressive period they've played in the playoffs against New Jersey. The sharpest they've been mentally, killing penalties, as you see here to this point. They really haven't given up very much.
Sergei Fedorov, you saw a moment ago, and then Doug Brown. Red Wings resting at their bench. They got blistered pretty well between the second and third periods of Game 3, and then again when Scotty Bowman went public with what he had told them at the press conference after the loss.
Here, Mike, again, Lemieux takes the faceoff in favor of Bobby Carpenter, who starts at left wing because of that wrist problem he has.
You mentioned Lemieux and Richer. Lemieux, the leading goal scorer in the entire playoffs. Richer, the leading point getter on his team. Coffey with a pass on for Fedorov. Both of them are out there right now, but here's Fedorov shorthanded. Sergei Fedorov wanting to get by. Backhander hit the ball. Coffey has shot. It went wide. Rebound. Coffey scores. Detroit has gotten a shorthanded goal with 2 seconds left on the penalty kill.
If Fedorov gets you one-on-one, watch out. He may have trouble with the hitting and the banging and getting through the neutral zone, but if he can isolate you one-on-one, like this, something happens. There he goes to the outside with a long reach. The sharp edge turn and hits the goal post. And New Jersey never recovered. Never recovered at all. Puck off the backboards. Coffey had 2 shots at it and finally ended up scoring. And Detroit leads 2-1 with a shorthanded goal. There's where the Devils had problems. Carpenter and Chambers crisscrossed, lost the puck. Fedorov goes to work. Now, when he shoots the puck here, watch the Devils all go to one side. They're over at one side and they never recover. The puck is going the Detroit way for the first time, and Coffey gets a big, big go-ahead goal.
Coffey, his 6th of the playoffs and 1st of the series, and the 1st by a defenseman in this series for Detroit. Brown and Fedorov get the assists at 13:01. Airy is out of the penalty box. The teams are back at full strength. Danico and Stevens, the defense for New Jersey. The pass fed over for Bill Guerin, trying to work his way by. Guerin just muscled off enough by Kozlov so that Fetisov can turn from behind. Slava Fetisov picks up reinforcements, gives back across. Trying to move in that time with Roy. LaPointe was just freight train down, and there'll be a penalty coming up. It'll be against New Jersey, and Detroit, which has just gotten the lead, will now have a power play and a chance to enlarge it.
You want to talk about team defense. Every Red Wings back behind the goal line. That allows Fetisov to head out with the puck from behind the goal, and that led to this play in the New Jersey zone as Danico went up high. And there's the penalty as LaPointe drew it. So Detroit getting the shorthanded goal to give them the 2-1 lead. Now have a power play and in a good position here.
Roughing to Danico at 13:36. Coffey and Lidstrom will work the points on the power play. Iserman and Primo and Ciccarelli. A lot of lightning in those sticks up front. The killers for New Jersey. The forwards are McLean and Carpenter. The defensemen, Niedermeyer and Stevens. Primo got there first, got it to Ciccarelli, but the pass blocked. Fed to the back to Coffey. Primo. Iserman. Shot blocked. Taken by Stevens. Given on to McLean. And McLean makes them go back.
Iserman, a right-handed shot, had to take the pass, turn his body, and take time to get the shot. That allowed Bobby Carpenter to make the real good defensive play in blocking it.
To the wing to LaPointe. Brodeur up with that one. Nudged it along, but Fedorov will get there first. Sergei Fedorov wrapped up by Niedermeyer, and the puck spiked back down the ice. So Vernon Cradle sweeps over for Lidstrom, who is just waltzed to the corner by Broughton. But here they come. Slava Kozlov eyed up by Driver. And the puck out of play at the photographer's bench. 5:19 to go in the first and 55 seconds remaining to be played on the Devils' minor penalty to Danico.
Only one attempted shot so far of any significance by Detroit. Ooh, guess what that is? That is the Stanley Cup inside the travel box. When it's handled, the gentlemen that do it put on white gloves, and then they get it out. This team right here is just dreaming about it. But I'll tell you, For the first time in this series, Detroit is really standing up for themselves. They've been issued a challenge by their coaching staff. The players weren't happy about it. They were not happy at all about what Mr. Scotty Bowman said about them. But those were the cold, hard facts, the truth. And they've responded so far.
Paul Coffey gliding in, could not fight his way by and lost it. Cleared back out by Brodeur. 35 still left on the minor penalty. The NHL had the Stanley Cup on display over the weekend, and it was supposed to remain at the hotel where it was being shown until Monday afternoon. But the Devils winning the first three forced a little bit of a change. Racing back is McClain, so Vernon has to come out. McClain heads to the bench on a change in lines, and 12 for New Jersey to kill.
An excellent job by the Devils. This was one that was necessary for them, and they've been aggressive. They haven't given up a thing. Oh, boy.
There will be a penalty.
Primo. Brodeur played the puck. Most people would say, that's okay. Primo could go in there because the goaltender had the puck. That's wrong. Goaltenders are not fair game. Primo should have avoided the goaltender. He did not. Now he goes to the box. Primo makes no attempt whatsoever to avoid the goaltender. In fact, exploded a little bit on hitting Brodeur. That's a penalty. So Detroit, who had the power play and a 2-1 lead, couldn't score. New Jersey did a great job penalty killing. Have a chance now instead of being down 3-1 on a power play goal. If they get one themselves, they may tie it up at two.
Both teams with a goaltender in four for 1 second. Both teams have had a power play, and both teams have had only 17 seconds of attack time out of 2 minutes or a little less. Now the power play on for New Jersey, their second of the game. They trail in the game 2-1. Broughton has the lone New Jersey goal. Fedorov and Coffey, the goals for Detroit. Long pass on now to Sergei Breland. Hands it across. Moving in is Niedermeyer. Chopped right back off and out again by Chris Draper. Albeline hands on to Richie. Stefan Richie, ever dangerous, took some wax. Fed one right into Draper. Lifted along, and Albeline has to play a neutralize. Niedermeyer again. Took the hit, rolled it around. Konstantinov steps to this. Still battling, can't clear. Pinching is Albeline, brushing it along. Guerin drove it behind. Moving into the other corner is Niedermeyer. Took the hit from Brown. Lifted further, pinching again. Breland this time. Around behind him, he rams into Ramsey. Devils outman, Bill Guerin. Fed it to the point, but Niedermeyer couldn't stop it. Striding for it is Fedorov. Fedorov got there, could not get by Albelina, and then recovered to brush one across the goal mouth. Brown with a drive, and Brodeur stopped that one.
Fedorov skating like the Fedorov we've seen for a couple of seasons. He is absolutely exploding at any loose puck.
Bill Guerin tried to get by, and Coffey said no. Half a minute now for Detroit to kill. Draper up front with Yzerman for Detroit. In back, Paul Coffey working with Bob Rouse. McClain and McKay, along with Neil Broughton, the forwards for New Jersey, and it's handed to Broughton, who's in! Save made by Vernon! Driver with a shot on! Vernon got that one! Yzerman lays it back out. It is a two-line pass for Draper, and play is stopped.
Fedorov exploding while killing penalties here in the first period. He's over here. He's going to head up and finds a loose puck. He's reading the play, reading the play. Here he'll help as the puck jumps away from the defenseman, and there he goes. When he was a young boy, he was invited to the Red Army team in Moscow, and he learned his trade there. Now, Mike Vernon hasn't had much work. Watch this save on Broughton, a kick save, and then he recovers with Sean Chambers all over him. There's goalie interference that Chambers got away with, and Vernon made a second save.
Crowd urged on by the scoreboard responding. Hoping that the Devils will do the same to get it tied. Bruce Driver up with it. Off the glass. Rouse pursued by Lemieux. Coffey could not finesse McClain, who kicked it along. The jostling continues. Penalty time is now up, and the teams are back at full strength. Driver finesses it back over. Chambers shoots. Score!
What a great fake shot by Driver, his defense partner, and he made the pass across. That opened up the ice. Detroit's back deep. See how deep they are? Everybody's back deep. Primo's now coming out of the penalty box. There he is. But that opens up the points. Oh, what a pay play that was. Look at this shot. Rolling puck and everything. Chambers still blasted it. Great shot. Look at Detroit, one man down. Look at the puck on edge. It's hard for a goaltender to find the flight of the puck when it's on edge. It's a knuckleball with velocity. Vernon thinks low shot. He's surprised up high. We're tied up at two. Like this, that means the defensemen back here are wide open. Primo will come out of the penalty box as we roll it. And Quebec, now we stop it there. Watch the fake shot by Driver and the pass across. Look at these guys all down. That allows Chambers, as we roll it, to get a good clean shot. Now we stop it again. Man here, man here. Vernon's got to think about him. Is the shot going to be low? Chambers surprises everybody. As Vernon goes down, the puck goes up. And we're tied at two. Boy, did Driver make a great play to fake the shot and pass it across to Sean Chambers. Bruce Driver will be an unrestricted free agent at the end of the season, whenever the finals are over. Oh, man. He'll be a prime piece of property for some team in the league.
Lou Lamoriello, 15 years at Providence College as a coach, as well as an athletic director during part of that time. You saw him for just a moment, the general manager of this team, watching nervously, wanting to be a part of his first Stanley Cup championship squad here in New Jersey. Stevens rolling it back. Konstantinov takes it there. Detroit at one point had outshot New Jersey 7-2. It is now 8-8. Chambers from Driver and McLean at 17:45. Krushelnicki to Fetisov. Trickler taken by Stevens and he pulls away. All of the grit and the hitting and the attacking and the strategy of Detroit, and we're back even. Stevens worked over pretty well. Fetisov crunched McKay.
Yeah, he hit him. The Red Wings are keeping coffee off the ice whenever this big crash line's out there. Fetisov and Konstantinov, two big defensemen, are on the ice whenever that big crash line's out there to be able to absorb the punishment.
When you've played it one way all year, is one period enough to make a team believers in a brand new system?
You wonder about this whole scenario. Detroit's got to feel good about the way they played. They've given it their best shot, yet New Jersey's tied them. It's an amazing, I think, first period, the way the plays have developed, the way the teams have played. New Jersey, no matter what teams throw at them, they find a way to survive, and they've survived a very good first period by Detroit.
Here's Richie throwing it back in. Ramsey back to get that one. Dealt it off to Fetisov with 40 to play in the first. Tommy Albelin stopped that one. And then Niedermeyer. Crash line is off. Chorsky, McLean, and Broughton are on for New Jersey. Chorsky could not get a good shot away because of the defensive work of Sergei Fedorov. And it's laid back ahead by Bob Rauch. And swept past Kozlov. Mike Vernon handed it over. 10 to go. Chorsky locks up with Rouse. Iserman came in. And the captain for Detroit is reefed pretty well by Niedermeyer. And one last McLean hit on Kozlov.
Kozlov, one of those players that the New Jersey Devil coaching staff said hit, hit, and hit some more. At the end of the period, John McLean hit him hard. This was a very interesting first period.
Eight shots apiece, two goals apiece, through 20 hard, gritty minutes. More in a moment.
Game, and certainly that's the question that remains to be answered. We'll find that out. But from that first period of play, let's take a look at the highlights. And there's no question that the New Jersey Devils were ready to play this one, very focused, and no question their fans were
ready. My goodness, that must have been a football fan, JB. Stephane Richer makes a great play wide here. This goal sparked a little controversy. It was early in the hockey game. They're going to go to the videotape to figure out whether that puck was kicked in by Neil Broughton in front of the net. I don't think they were able to determine whether it was or wasn't. So they ruled it a goal. The Devil fans are happy. And we're going to move along here. This play was the result of the fact. Now look at Stevens, puts his hand to his face. He never gets back in position to get where he's supposed to be. You see him come late into the play. As a result of that hesitation, he was never in position. The banging continued. Detroit came to play. Was there a thought that they weren't going to show up? They showed up for sure, JB, with plays like that. You cannot give Sergei Fedorov open ice. This play was the result of the fact that Fedorov got the puck in the neutral zone. That caused Coach Jacques Lemaire to cringe. You cannot give Fedorov open ice.
And you like the physical play shown by Detroit because you said, in fact, they did show up to play.
Well, they sure did show up. That play was created. Bruce Driver, nice fake. What a good period of hockey.
And we're all tied at two. Maybe a good sign for Detroit. Paul Coffey scoring his first goal of the series. And, folks, we've got more coming your way from insider Brendan Byrne Arena. All tied at two. Back with more after this.
Deadlock at two after a period of play. The best 20 minutes by Detroit. And just a little bit ago, our Joe Micheletti caught up with Red Wings' Keith Primo.
Three, your team came out inspired. What went on in the last 48 hours?
We really had some good meetings for the last 48 hours. We felt that we haven't played the way it took us to get here, and now we're just trying to get back to it. And they're a great hockey club over there. That was a pretty good 20-minute period by the Detroit Red Wings, and they're still tiedless 2-2. So we just got to build from that period and try and play better.
Now, you played very physical in the first period. How'd the injury hold up?
I felt pretty good. Still a little sore, but every day it's getting better, so that's a positive.
Thanks for your time. JB, back to you.
All right, Joe, thank you very much, and I think safe to say that the Red Wings were sufficiently inspired by the public tongue-lashing that Scotty Bowman gave them, and they're all tied at two after a period of play. 20 more minutes coming up in the second period of play, and we will rejoin Mike Kimmerick and John Davidson and take a look at the Cup after this.
The NHL on Fox, the Stanley Cup Finals, brought to you by Dodge. The more things change, the more things look like the new Dodge. By the Discover Card, it pays to discover the card that pays you back. By Nike, who encourages you to participate in the lives of America's youth. And by Speedstick by Menin. Like you, it never quits.
Laser show outside, a crunching show inside. During that first 20 minutes, a lot of pucks were shot by sticks like that, and about that fast. Both teams got two goals. Let's return to the philosophy of this game. First of all, for New Jersey, you said they've got to play their system, did they?
Mike, I thought that at the first portion of the period, Detroit was out shooting, I think with over 12 minutes left, out shooting New Jersey 6-1. The shots ended up 8-8. I think New Jersey got into their game more as they moved along. Detroit, on the other hand, had eight shots, seven of them by defensemen. 7 out of 8. I think that's something that I'm sure the Devils will address during the intermission. And Detroit, as Keith Primo said and Dave Maloney mentioned, I don't think they can play a better period. And they have to continue to play with the passion they showed more than anything else and try to take advantage of any mistake that the Devils make, because they don't make many of them.
This game summary is brought to you by Bud Ice. Rotten and Chambers have scored for New Jersey. Fedorov and Coffey for Detroit. Shots even. Six goals allowed by Mike Vernon in the last 28 shots. The one that tied it up, a blistering drive by Chambers with 2:15 to go in the period. When the second period gets underway, there will be no carryover penalties, no carryover power plays. Chris Draper has become one of the more significant spokesmen. It's interesting how that evolves as the playoffs go on. Very glib guy, speaks well, seems very confident at that. And so at a time when not everyone wants to face the camera, Chris has been one of the guys that's been prominent.
He used to be a member of the Winnipeg Jets organization, sold for $1. $1. That's getting value for your money, is it not?
Indeed. It is Coffey as well as Rouse to start the period for Detroit. Primo working with Martin Lapointe and also Fedorov up front. Danico turned that one along. Sent along by Fedorov, it trickled through for Scott Stevens to play. It is Lemieux and Richie, as well as Carpenter, the frontline combination for Jacques Lemaire's New Jersey Devils. Fedorov with a steal, backhander, turned aside by Brodeur.
Penalty coming up to New Jersey as Detroit starts quickly. So I think they must have fed off of how they played in the first period, discussed it during the intermission, and they start quickly here. LaPointe, ooh, man, did he catch Danico away from the puck. My goodness. LaPointe, a big forward, put on the ice, and Kenny Danico reacted. Primo there took a shot from Scotty Stevens, and you can see that bothered him, or it appeared to bother him, even though he stayed on the ice to start this power play. So Kenny Danico, who was absolutely blindsided, and the referee must not have seen that, Danico reacted after and ends up in the penalty box. Kenny Danico is one of the true leaders for this hockey club. In Secaucus, New Jersey, about a mile and a half from here, Max and June McNabb sitting and watching right now. Max McNabb was a member of this organization for a lot of years and responsible for bringing in people like Kenny Danico and John McClain and Bruce Driver. And I'm sure he's a proud man sitting and watching his Devils go to work.
Hoping that they can win their first Stanley Cup, and he won one as a player, as a member of the Detroit Red Wings of the 1950s. Iserman trying to work it in front, can't do it. Puck taken by Cicerelli. Coffey hurries one, and it's skipped wide of Martin Brodeur in the goal. McClain, but it's kept by Lidstrom. Rolled around Cicerelli there. Oh, was he bumped into by Niedermeyer. Off the rail. It came over to Scott Stevens. Leads it out for Broughton in a shorthanded rush. Broughton back over to Stevens. Quick one in front, and it was behind McClain. Now the Devils have to hustle to get back. Moving ahead with it is Iserman. Testing Stevens. Feeding on over for Cicerelli. Driver bangs into him. Then back to the point. Waiting is Coffey. Lindstrom deflected wide by Cicerelli. Swept out in front and cleared away by Driver. Lindstrom back over to Coffey again. Back to Lindstrom once more. Wristed one that's slowed down by McClain. Follow up comes from Iserman, but he's checked. Now it's Bruce Driver. Kept at the point. Lindstrom gave it up to Broughton, who threw it back down. Over halfway through the Devils penalty kill. It's laid ahead for Fedorov. Fedorov cranks the heart around. Brodeur got a piece of it. Chipped along by Chambers. Coffey kept it alive. Driver swung it back. Two minutes played, second period. Just one shot on goal this period, that by Detroit. Coffey gliding right ahead. Paul Coffey wanting to turn by Alvelin. Here's Coffey behind. Fed it to the point. Batisov, a shot deflected. Punched away by Alvelin and played back out by Chorsky. A dozen seconds on the Red Wings power play. The Devils make another change up front. Chambers and Alvelin in back. Broughton and McClain, the forwards. Turned aside by Brodeur. A check off and Fedorov, a shot that saved another shot.
When you're on the power play, you have to outnumber the other team to recover the puck. Now here's the puck put into the corner. It's a two-on-two play. Now all of a sudden in comes Primo, and there's three red jerseys. They recover the puck. And now you see the chance for the shot. Dino Cicerelli in front. The puck just misses. And Brodeur tried to recover the puck. On the last chance here, again, Detroit. This is called a smart dump into the puck. And Brodeur does a nice play in kicking it into the corner. But again, the Red Wings goal and outnumber New Jersey, recover the puck, and there's Brodeur making two saves. The thing about Brodeur's goaltending, his style never gets him in trouble. Never. He's never out too far. Even when he's down, he's in a position to recover. His body's always seems to be squeezed together. Very few pucks slide through his legs or between his arm and his body. He's a very intelligent goaltender. Only 23 years of age. Very strong, too. 6'1" and strong physically.
He has seen about every movie that is out. The day before every game, he goes with some teammates to a movie. Yesterday, it was Bridges of Madison County. His review, it moved kind of slow for me.
It is a little slow when Clint Eastwood's in it.
Well, a middle-aged Clint Eastwood, anyway.
Even Clint Eastwood slows down. Is that what you're saying? Just like the rest of us. Thank God.
Here comes Tom Chorsky. Chorsky crossing. Jammed aside in traffic and handled by Batisov. Laid back on out for a pass by Krushelnicki to Chris Draper. Draper with a shot, and that stopped and then swept away by Niedermeyer. Neil Broughton up with it, but Draper took it away from him. Chris Draper couldn't get it to the front. Draper trying to recover again, but Batisov must corral it in center ice. Five shots in this period, all by Detroit. Odor takes that one. For Albeline, skip back to neutralize. Tommy Albeline hands it across to Niedermeyer. The Let's Go Devils chant starts. Lidstrom flips it back out. Niedermeyer controlling as the Devils make a line change. Mike Ramsey controlling behind. Bangs it back off. Stevens, one time shot, went to the air. Gloved down by Ramsey. Stevens again with a shot, and that one skips wide. It's Big Pete Primo. But the pass is taken by Stevens. Drive, and that went off a leg wide. Ralston rolling it around. Karen centered, but it's off Freeland's stick. Primo trying to step away, cannot. Stevens tried to finesse. Guerin up with it. Back to Freeland. Shoots one, and that blocked aside.
Great play by Primo, who had lost his stick. This has been an exhausting shift for him as the Devils continue the pressure.
No shots on goal for them in this attack. Puck to the back now to Danico. Shoots one, and that one sailed wide on the wrister. LaPointe feverishly trying to clear camp.
Primo got his stick back now.
And a stoppage of play. 4:35 played in the second. We're still tied up at two. So the second period is unfolded here. Almost a fourth of it played, and it's been all Detroit in shots on goal at 5-0.
Scotty Bowman just put four players on the ice, waited. The Devils put all their players on the ice, and then Scotty Bowman threw Fedorov on there because there's no Carpenter and there's no Scotty Stevens. So now Jacques Lemaire's mad at the referee. So we have Fedorov out there, no Carpenter, no Stevens. That hasn't happened very often in the series.
Driver across, one-time shot, and getting a piece of it was Vernon. Letting it go was Niedermeyer. Down along by Chorsky. Paul Coffey, checked off by Broughton. Broughton got it over for McLean. Checked to the corner with authority by Rouse. Dino Ciccarelli put it back out. Niedermeyer and Driver the defense. McLean, Chorsky, and Broughton up front, but then a quick change by the Devils. They get Carpenter and Claude Lemieux out there.
They want those players out there simply because of Fedorov.
Here comes Lemieux. Shoots one, and it went wide. Hanging on is Mike Vernon. And downstairs is Joe Micheletti.
Okay, Mike, a couple of things. The coaches from both teams, first Detroit, felt the two goals that they gave up in that period they weren't happy with. The defensive play on the second goal, but the first goal, the one by Neil Broughton, they felt not only did Neil Broughton kick the puck in, but they felt that he was also in the crease. Meanwhile, New Jersey's coaching staff, they felt that they had their worst period of the final series thus far. Back up to you, Mike.
All right, so two coaches not happy.
What else is
done? Yeah.
And they got out of it, tied up at two. Well, they're backboards here. When players miss the net, the puck fires right out front so quick. That makes the goaltender worry about going out too far from his goal crease. So you can't play the angle too much. If the player misses the net, the puck comes right back in front real quick.
Tough save, 6-4, Brodeur. Brodeur has faced more shots. Driver up with this one. Niedermeyer fires, rebound, sent wide.
Not only New Jersey winning faceoffs, but they're getting great shots after winning the faceoffs.
Richet held off. Batisov tried to get by, could not. Vernon sent it around, and Yzerman takes over. Bruce Driver chases it. Ciccarelli on him. Swung right back and taken by Konstantinov. Dino Ciccarelli turning with it. Laying it across for Primo. Primo trying to dip around behind. Pete Primo controlling now for Detroit. Yzerman can't get to the front. Flips one, and it's nudged right in toward Brodeur, and he hangs on.
We're tied up at two. This is a shot from Niedermeyer off the faceoff win by New Jersey. Watch in front. There. Konstantinov does a nice job checking his man so the rebound doesn't beat Mike Vernon. Keith Primo has such a large reach. He was able to get the puck in deep that led to this offense, but not a good clean shot as the Devils are getting stronger and stronger in their own zone.
Their history this year has been to get stronger and stronger as each period goes by. One of the best teams in the third period, not only in the regular season, but in these playoffs. Very little else can be compared from the New Jersey that we saw in the regular season to the New Jersey that has emerged here in the playoffs. The middle of March, it didn't even look like they'd make the playoffs because they were technically out of the top eight in their conference.
Injuries do that, that's for sure.
That was part
the addition of Paul Broughton, or pardon me, Neil Broughton, has certainly helped the Devils.
Jacques Lemaire is trying to become the third student of Scotty Bowman as a player to win a Stanley Cup championship as a coach. Al Arbour and Terry Crisp were the earlier two. Conversation, of course, before this final series centered around the teacher and the pupil and the typical things that you would have emerging. But one of the stories was that when Bowman was coaching Lemaire, they won five Stanley Cups, and Lemaire was the only guy who would ask the question, how? Out in front, oh, and a backhander by McKay! It's held off by Vernon. The Devils sneaked an attack through, and Randy McKay, who's been one of the top goal scorers of the series, almost got one.
Mike Vernon got Detroit into the finals. Scotty Bowman said, yeah, I'm going to play him, even though we're down 3-0. There's Detroit. Lidstrom makes the pass, and it does not connect. And here comes that counterattack. The Devils find a way to get offense, and Vernon stayed with it. He was partially down, but he stayed with it on McKay as Peluso looked for the rebound. This pass with a rolling puck does not connect, as you see there. Turnover at the blue line. Detroit going in one direction. Now they're caught. Lidstrom gets caught one-on-one, and this time Mike Vernon, he wins it. He's had a good second period, as has Brodeur, with the score tied at two.
Coffey connects with LaPointe, but then it's off him. Stevens nubs one back in. Shots in the period, six for Detroit, two for New Jersey. Game tied at two. Lemieux swinging it back ahead, and Paul Coffey just lobs it back in. Stevens back to play.
Watch Detroit here with what they call a delayed forecheck. Kozlov's deep. Everybody else is back towards the blue line. They're playing a very similar style in this game that New Jersey uses as their strength. Everybody knows it is the neutral zone trap. That's one reason, I think, why we have a goal, or a game that's only had one goal apiece with even strength scoring.
Kozlov onto LaPointe. Lemieux sends it over for Richer. Coffey recovers. Jacques Lemaire was saying that he's seeing this as a trend now. Of course, New Jersey getting to the finals and being one away from a championship would mean that it would be a trend that would start if it hadn't already. He's noticed it in junior hockey, in the American and International Hockey Leagues this year, too.
I think more than anything else, Mike, it came over here from Europe where they have large ice surfaces. You can't chase the puck all the time, so you play positional hockey.
Here is Lemieux. Held off by Konstantinov, but he got it on to Bill Guerin. Guerin watched by Betizov, got it over for Niedermeyer. Swung one in front, no!
First lead of the game for New Jersey, and this place is jumping. Look at the play as the puck is taken to the outside by Billy Guerin, and in front, Broughton is wide open. A valiant effort by Mike Vernon to keep the puck away, but finally it was jammed in. You see, Betisov's gone down and Bob Airy's gone down. When you leave your feet, you can't recover. There's Vernon with two saves and a third one where the puck just crawls up and over top of his shoulder. Broughton stays with it. The Broughton, he's left alone because Bob Airy had gone down. Save and a save, and look at the puck. Crawls up and over. It's 3-2 New Jersey.
Broughton with his second of the game. Guerin and Niedermeyer, the assists at 7:56, 3-2 in favor of the Devils.
Billy Guerin, with that great speed, was able to move into the zone and twist the defenseman Betisov right down to the egg surface before making the play.
The speed he's got, but size he has too. Thrown around behind, Doug Brown can't come up with it. Rushed away from Ralston by Lidstrom. Brown trying to center, but it's off the back of the goal. Bruce Driver moving it back out for New Jersey. Cranks it back in. Vernon just lets it go. off of Ramsey. Played along to Guerin again. Bill Guerin crosses, can't get a shot away. Breland couldn't reach it. Keith Primo could and brings it on. Now it's Breland. Chambers with a drive blocked by Mike Ramsey and tucked back out. Chambers just laying it across as Mike Ramsey, member of that 80 U.S. gold medal winning Olympic team, right there, number 15, made a strong block.
Detroit started the period quickly. New Jersey is taking it over. They've beaten Vernon now to take the lead, and they haven't stopped since that point. They're carrying the speed of the game now, the Devils are. Here's Detroit backing out. Now they're going to try to force turnovers.
Gary with the shoulder on McClain. Roush takes over on defense. Stevens could not keep. There'll be no icing on this. Once again, Tommy Albelin shuffles it off the glass, and Roush waiting for this one. Across to Paul Coffey. Roush goes the other way to Cicerelli. Offside. Play stopped here, nearing the middle point of our game. The Devils have the lead over the Red Wings 3-2.
Big Stu Grimson, sometimes when you don't get a lot of ice time, you do what you can to try to fire your team up. And he's trying to do that. Draper with a big hit there on Billy Guerin. Breland with a little help from his side. I must apologize. I said for the first time the Devils have led. I should say the first time in this period. The Devils opened the scoring with Broughton getting the goal early in the game. I apologize for that.
Broughton resting at the bench. The big boys are out right now. Bringing it on and rolling it back in is Stu Grimson. Scott Stevens back to play it. Oh, going low on him was LaPointe. LaPointe battling with Stevens in the corner. Fedorov crunches in. Carpenter took it away. Back up to Lemieux. Can't get it by Konstantinov. A wrestling match in the corner.
And LaPointe and Stevens, who started in behind the goal net, and LaPointe, low bridge Stevens, they just kept right at it all the way along the boards. Finally, Bill McCurry blew the whistle, and it may be a trade-off of LaPointe, who's already drawn two penalties in the game. He may be going off with Scott Stevens for a rest. Not much after the whistles in this game. Here's Grimson and Richie. If Grimson gets somebody like Richie in the penalty box for a long period of time, he'll win the battle. Even if they get, sometimes referees will give out 10-minute misconducts when they go at it after whistles. And if that indeed happens here, a Grimson-Richie is a win for Detroit. LaPointe came flying in. Stevens knew he had to get to the puck, and he had two men bearing down on him, and LaPointe went low. Scott Stevens likes to do that himself a lot of times, go low when he throws a body check. Well, they continue to really push and shove here, Fetisov and Chambers. Here's Stevens. He's got a man coming from each side of the net. Boom! LaPointe went down and low, and they just stayed right after one another. All along the boards, they continue to battle and battle. It catches the hip here of Stevens, I think, more than anything else. Not the knee, thankfully. Stevens was okay to get up and battle as they continue to push and shove. You haven't seen very much of this at all in the playoffs. Now they casually separate. Most players have their gloves on.
Over the last 3 years, the fighting has dropped off markedly, especially in the playoffs. John was talking about size earlier. When the guys were big the last time, it was the mid-70s, but it was size, not necessarily combined with skill, because they needed fighters. Well, in these playoffs, 80 games have been played. There have been 10 fights, and none in the last month of playoff competition. It's been just fierce like this. But Stu Grimson was the last guy to have a fight. It was in the second round with Jeff Hodgers of San Jose.
You talked about having fighters back in the 70s. We had Dave Maloney. My buddy.
And you realize he doesn't have a microphone nearby. There's no rejoinder coming. Just a pause right now to cool things off. Scotty Bowman said he wanted a low-scoring game. Sounded kind of odd coming from a man whose team had led the league in total goals scored for the last two full regular seasons, finished third only to Pittsburgh and Quebec in this shortened season. This is not really low scoring, but is 3-2 by Devils standards. It's starting to get high scoring because they normally don't give up more than three.
Yeah, when the Devils score three goals, generally they win, period. I think with Scotty Bowman, his hockey club has given up two goals right around the goal crease, both by Broughton. They've also given up the power play goal by Chambers, but both by Broughton, getting around the goal crease, finding a way to find the puck.
Talking about size, Joe Micheletti has some friends not far away in our Meadowlands Arena in East Rutherford, New Jersey tonight.
Yep. Oh, okay, Mike, yeah, I sure do. With me is Dave Schultz and Boris Kindrichuk. Both these players are celebrating an anniversary. 20 years since the Philadelphia Flyers won their second Stanley Cup. And I guess this type of action out here, Dave, you're used to got a little bit of a smile on your face.
Well, this is the first time I've seen any kind of little mix-up, but playoff hockey is exciting, and this is a great game, and everybody's excited here.
Boris, how does that make you feel when you sit here watching a Stanley Cup final?
You wish you could play one more game. That's all. One more game would be tremendous.
We had a chance to look at the Stanley Cup. How about if we take a look at those championship rings that you guys are wearing? That's what these guys are playing for. There they are right there.
I would love to have one of these.
Unfortunately, not. A lot of guys play a lot of years, never have a chance. So I feel pretty privileged, and so does Boris and all of us, that we had a chance to win it.
Thanks, guys. Back up to you, Mike.
Boris Kindrichuk, an insurance agent in the Philadelphia area, and Dave Schultz runs a limousine service. And he gets full payment on all of his invoices.
Oh, I bet he does. Schultzy with one ring on each hand for the two cups they won.
You guys saw a lot of those hands over the years, didn't you? Without rings on them sometimes. Icy called, and a faceoff comes back near Martin Brodeur.
Well, Mike, that's the thing. One more game. Just wish you could play one more game. It's a more bitter feeling to lose in a Stanley Cup final than it is to not make the playoffs or lose in the first round. When you get this close, Cicerelli, 15 years worth, Stevie Eisenman, first ever final. When you lose in the final, believe me, it's something that haunts you the rest of your life. It's amazing how many times you can drive down a freeway and think about it 10 years later that you lost, even though you were there.
Coffey with a shot, deflected, and a save made by Brodeur. Eisenman was right at the front of the net.
Good play by Eisenman, winning the faceoff and then getting to the net. If you lose the draw, you shouldn't let your man go, and Eisenman was able to get away from his centerman, who was Broughton. You see it right in the middle. Now Eisenman releases, drives, and spins to get in front. Broughton got caught standing still. He's better than that. That very seldom happens to a player like Broughton. Let's see what happens on this faceoff. Eisenman wins. Broughton stays with him. Look at that. He's staying right with him.
Primo had trouble playing it. Eisenman pulls away from Broughton now, trying to play it in the corner, but Niedermeyer dominated. Right back it comes to the two of them, and Primo comes by. Then Eisenman again around to Primo. Albelin steps to him, and down he goes. Thrown off by Niedermeyer. Broughton turns with it. Scooped a pass, and it's a two-on-one. Niedermeyer giving over to John McClain. Moves in. Shoots, save, Burnham, rebound, and it went behind. Thrown by Niedermeyer. McClain has shot, and it slithered wide. Coffey takes over there for Detroit. A two-on-one. The only odd man rush that the Devils have been able to get. Right back now comes Paul Coffey. Tried to work one through, that failed. Sean Chambers shifts from defense to offense, handing over to McClain. No play, so he'll shoot. And it's deflected harmlessly to the glass. Both teams a man short for another 41 seconds. Stevens and LaPointe had those roughing minors. And it is Fedorov again. Sergei Fedorov got it over to Brown. Doug Brown shoveled it wide. And Lemieux brings it back for New Jersey. Got a pass over to Bobby Carpenter. The opening is for Lemieux, and he got loose. Shoots one. Save, Vernon. And he covers. And play is stopped. 8:10 to go. Second period. Still the Devils by one.
Mike, you said the only odd man rush for New Jersey. Coffey's moving in here, but watch these players go there too. There's going to be three on one white jersey. That shouldn't happen. Three of them. So Primo can't get back. It's a 2-on-1. That's Niedermeyer up top. McClain on the puck. And Mike Vernon gets the job done, stopping the 2-on-1. Niedermeyer, with that great speed, jumped in to help out the Devils' odd man rush.
We mentioned about New Jersey and how few goals they allow. They have only allowed three or less. They've allowed three or less in every playoff game except one. That was 2 weeks ago this very day when they lost 4-2 to Philadelphia. The Flyers in one game, the only team to get four on them.
A With 8 minutes to go in the second period, Detroit's already had 15 shots. That's almost a story in itself. That's a lot of shots New Jersey's given up.
In the very first game of this series, Detroit only had 17 total. Matisse off rolling it around. Both teams get a man back. It's full-strength hockey. Devils ahead, 3-2. The shots are 15-14 Detroit. On comes Slava Kozlov, hooked away from him by Richie. Konstantinov's pass to Fedorov was offside.
Scotty Bowman has played Fedorov, Yzerman, and Primo at center ice, and he's rotated his three centermen. Centermen. The wingers have been different all the time. He doesn't care what wingers are playing with one centerman, what centerman for this game. He knows his team's strength is their centerman when they're going. So he's tried to play them and play them and play them. But it looks like it's becoming exhausting to a person like Fedorov, who's played well. Talked about Fedorov skating earlier. I asked him, where'd you learn to do what you do? Great thighs, and you explode when you see the puck, and you want to skate to it. He said, when I was young, I was invited to play for the Red Army team, along with Mo Gildy, who plays in Buffalo, and Pavel Bure, the great player in Vancouver. And he said, we trained 11 months a year for four straight years. We were given 25 days off a year to take care of business and car payments and apartment or wives or whatever. 11 months a year we trained. That's where I learned to skate like I skate.
Stevens put it on goal and a save made by Vernon. Bob Rouse turns with it there. A penalty is coming up.
Billy Guerin knocked down Kozlov, and I think Guerin will get the minor penalty in the offensive zone here.
Finally, the Devils touch. Detroit to get the man advantage. They trail in the game. Second period, 3-2 New Jersey.
That's Bill Guerin picking up his man. The puck's on that side of the ice. That's the problem. So Guerin sees his man, turns around. Kozlov actually held him up. And then Guerin got mad and knocked Kozlov over. So Kozlov draws the penalty, or pardon me, yes, draws the power play for Scotty Bowman and his team as they trail by one.
Guerin in on an interference wrap at 12:43. And Detroit presented with the opportunity to tie this game. And here comes Paul Coffey. For Ciccarelli. Blocked aside by Stevens. Played along by Broughton. Lidstrom a shot, and it screamed wide off the boards. Coffey again. Outman. Yzerman. Back to the point. Lidstrom. Coffey. And a shot nubbed, and it went wide. Fedorov digs it out. Finesse one in front that's off a skate. Odor with a challenge, and McLean tried to clear it on. That failed. John McLean, all-time leading scorer, got it on over to Stevens for the clear.
Kenny Danico barks at the referee. Danico and Ciccarelli with their own private war in front of the goaltender Rodour.
McLean comes off, replaced by Tom Chorsky, as well as Bobby Carpenter. Floated back in. Niedermeyer to play it there. Yzerman on him. The puck squips to Ciccarelli. Dealt it along now for a play by Kozlov. Kozlov pursued by Driver and turned it into him and back out.
Fedorov with a short power play shift. I wonder if he is starting to tire a little bit. He's had a lot of ice time. He's played well, but is he tiring?
Deflected high on that pass from Kozlov. Puck back to the point. Matisse off a shot, and that one done. Carpenter goes to get in. Coffey keeps it alive. All Coffey, but it's intercepted by Carpenter. Punched along, and they battle for it. Right back out, and here comes Carpenter. One-on-one with Matisse off. Bobby Carpenter, a drive! And getting a piece of it was Vernon. Boy, Carpenter nearly run to the ditch by Primo. He got out of the way. And meanwhile, a lot of penalty time has gone off. 15 seconds for the Detroit power play. Primo on, and Coffey sent it in. Brodeur stops it behind. Right up the middle and right to Fetisov. Fetisov had one guided away by Danico. John McLean can't get loose for that one. Vernon out of his goal, plays it across. And it's Fetisov ahead.
Detroit with a lot of holdups, hooking, interfering. In fact, that's what led to the penalty to Billy Guerin by Kozlov. And the fans getting upset here. But the Devils aren't. That's the key. The players are not.
58 seconds of Detroit attack time on that last power play, but they did not get a shot. Konstantinov backs it off. Scott Stevens goes to play it there, and out in front it came. McLean without a stick. Made along by Krushelnicki. And now Bill Guerin, and McLean just flipped it back down with his glove. He comes to the bench. Devils in the midst of a change. Brown sets it up. Draper a shot that's deflected to the seats by Abilene. Play is stopped here at the Meadowlands Arena. Another bear hug of players in this 3-2 Devils lead.
Goaltenders are like homing pigeons. You don't want to get too far from home when you get rid of the puck. Get back to where you belong quick. John McClain with the Willie Mays basket catch. He looks up. He doesn't have his stick, so he does the next best thing. He dumps the puck right out of the zone. Like I said earlier about Guerin did get upset when he was interfered with by Kozlov and took the penalty on the retaliation. The Devils players can't as a group allow this clutching and holding, and they're being interfered with and not allowed to forecheck. They can't let that bother them and end up taking penalties and put themselves in the penalty box and make their penalty killers and goaltenders do the job for them. They've got to, actually, that's what they're good at. So they've got to live with it. They do it a lot. Now Detroit's trying to do it a lot.
That's the interesting point, because they've brought a lot of retaliatory penalties against them that led to their power plays with the same sort of thing. At the conclusion of our game, John and I will select a new Dodge player of the game. Latter stages of the second period. The shots are 16-15 in favor of New Jersey. Alvelin with a pass off Freeland. Konstantinov sends LaPointe ahead. LaPointe over to Yzerman. Steve Yzerman fed it across. Ramsey coming in front, and it's shanked wide by Airy on the rebound.
Great play by Yzerman. The puck was sitting there, but Detroit couldn't finish.
Freeland trying to finesse by. No sail from Konstantinov. LaPointe nudges it back for Yzerman, but he's met then by Chambers. Chambers pass misfired for Guerin.
Now we have a period of time where the Devils are turning the puck over, and Detroit is countering and starting to get some offense.
It is Chambers again. Leads it ahead for Broughton in an onside play, but he's wrestled to the corner by Coffey. Devils in the midst of another change. Dino Cicerelli's pass bounced near McClain, but is controlled by Bob Rouse. Sails it back, and Brodeur sets. Kreider taking it there. Pass intercepted by Primo. Missed for Cicerelli, though. And Paul Coffey lobs it back in. Kreider pursued. Got out of the way of the Primo hit. Gets the puck back again. Off the boards for Chorsky, and he's hit. Dino Cicerelli. A lot of play between the blue lines now. McClain flies it back in. Another change in lines for New Jersey. Primo comes off for Detroit and is replaced by Chris Draper. He deflected that one ahead, but Lemieux just plopped it back in. Rouse pursued by Richey. Cicerelli chipped it. Stevens must play in neutral ice, and the Devils regroup. This is now seeming like the recipe Scotty Bowman wanted. It worked really well in the first. Looked like the teams were starting to go end-to-end a little bit, as much as they're allowed. Here's Patisov with a shot. That went off the back of Cicerelli. They scrap for it, but emerging now is Richey. And Richey just angles it back in. It's virtually non-stop, but it's slower.
Slower. But the non-stop action where there was some scoring chances, Mike, was on the 4-on-4 action. Now they're back 5-on-5. There's less room. You have to work harder to go through people.
McCarty with a pass that ricocheted in front and is covered by Brodeur, and play is stopped.
And Draper knocked down Alvelin, the defenseman, to get open. And they're trying to get to the goaltender. Brodeur just gets up and skates away as everybody else starts to push and shove. The Detroit defense can stay away from joining the pushing and shoving to make sure the faceoff stays in the New Jersey zone with under 2 minutes to go here in the second period. Here we see on the left side of the ice, number six, Alvelin. He's got his man, but his man knocks him down. That opens up the ice. All of a sudden, Brodeur's got to reach out, find the puck, and then you see the support as Breland, number 18, got back to help out the defenseman who was knocked down. There's a good change of speed to the outside. The puck's in front. You know, that was a nice play by Brodeur. The pass across, he used his goal stick to stop the puck from there, from getting to the target where it was supposed to go, and then held on. And you see Draper driving to the net, doing everything he can. Brodeur did not get upset by this pushing and shoving. Watch the goal stick. Beautiful, right there. Draper tries to find the puck, and Brodeur takes away the low shot, does a nice job in covering up, even though he was attacked.
From the faceoff, the Devils have it. And Alvelin angles it back out. John McClain able to pull away. McClain sent one in front, guided away by Vernon. And it's Kozlov in the final 100 seconds of the second period. Bouncer in on Brodeur, and he hangs on. You often notice goaltenders talking to the officials, as Brodeur did during the stoppage of play. part of that engaging them to get them on your side to blow the whistle quickly, for example?
Oh, absolutely. And as soon as the puck got into Brodeur's glove on that little play, the referee blew the whistle immediately.
So it worked.
Absolutely. I think one thing we've seen in this game is Detroit's really tried to crowd Brodeur, really tried to get him off his game. In fact, Primo took a penalty in the first period, bumping the goaltender. Billy McCreary, as a good referee does, recognizes it, and he wants to blow the whistle to keep players away from engaging the goaltender.
Bill McCreary, 11th year in the league. They start with a staff of 59, and by the time you get to the finals, there are only seven officials left, three referees and four linesmen. It's all on merit, and it's an honor to be here, and Bill McCreary knows that. This is the second game of the series that he's worked, also having game one in Detroit.
And he does a nice job communicating with the players and coaching staff. That's one of his strengths. So I'm sure he doesn't mind talking to Brodeur.
Ahead comes Yzerman. Yzerman menaced by Driver, and just that little flick of the wrist enough to send it away in a two-on-one. Chorsky with McKay. Chorsky with a rising shot that got the glass. Now here's Yzerman jamming it back. Second odd man rush for New Jersey the period.
Yeah, the Red Wings didn't get the puck deep, Mike. You get to the blue line, you've got to get it deep. If you don't, your players are going in the opposite direction and you're dead.
Here is Randy McKay moving in. McKay couldn't get a shot away. A penalty coming up.
Konstantinov, it's a good penalty too. With 48 seconds to go, he had to do something as McKay broke in. So Konstantinov knocked McKay down, taking away the scoring chance. Two turnovers by the Red Wings in the last minute really hurt them. Look at that pass. McKay lost control for just a moment of the puck, and watch the hook and the pull and knocking off balance of McKay by Konstantinov. That sends Konstantinov to the penalty box. If the Devils score here, it's 4-2 with one period to go, and they'd be very tough. Konstantinov had to do something to take the scoring chance away. Twice Detroit had the puck in the neutral zone, never got it deep to Brodeur's end of the ice, and those turnovers kill him. Just kill him. Absolutely kill him, and it's cost him a penalty here. Here you see Detroit on the puck. On the puck, moving up ice. Get it deep, get it deep. Nope, it's not deep. Yzerman never got it deep. There's the pass, and it's a 2-on-1. Chorsky missed the net. And the next play is the one where Konstantinov took the penalty.
Coffey wraps it around. Chambers kept it alive. Freeland there, shoved off by Coffey. Into Richie. Better off reaching for it, but then Freeland. Bill McCreary found himself in the middle of that, pinching in his Driver, but it's rattled back off. 24 to go in the period. Chambers taking it. Red Wings have made a change up front. They have Draper working up front along with Steve Yzerman now, and in back, Rouse and Coffey. To the final dozen of the period. Driver put it in. Coffey back to take it. And it bounced to Draper to top it back out. And that'll do it. 40 minutes have been played. Only one goal in that period, and that was the tiebreaker, the second of the game by Neil Broughton. Two periods played, and the Devils lead it 3-2.
Folks, this is the Holy Grail, that which is being fought for, and 20 minutes remain in regulation to see whether or not New Jersey can do it. And New Jersey right now leading after two periods of play by the score of 3-2. James Brown along with Dave Maloney. And Dave, as you mentioned before, again, no change in the style of play from New Jersey. They are steady and consistent.
Well, I think that, and that's the factor. We mentioned beforehand that New Jersey is going to play 60 minutes of their hockey. They tighten the ice up after they open the ice up for Fedorov, but New Jersey, no difference. A little tighter, keep plugging away.
And speaking of no difference, let's give Detroit some credit as we take a look at the highlights. No change in the intensity. Look at Martin Lapointe delivering a hit on Danico.
Oh, boy, that's a payback, I think, from Stevens on Kozlov. You talk about the open ice. This is what I speak of. 91 is much too dangerous to give him that kind of room. Paul Coffey going to knock in a shorthanded rebound goal there. Now, I want you to pay attention to Bruce Driver at the top of the screen. He's going to make a great fake right there. Down go two Red Wings. That opens up the ice, and Chambers cranks it home and beats Vernon to the high side. That was late in the first. Again, this was much like the Devils' first goal. Billy Guerin wide, Neil Broughton gets himself in front and perseveres, and they talk about paying the price. He does that. Stauskas low. Now watch the puck. Over it comes. And oh, Mike Vernon, a little exasperated in the net. 3-2 hockey game, JB.
And that's exactly where we stand after two. And as you mentioned again, the ice has gotten just a little smaller thanks to New Jersey's strong defense. Folks, when we come back, we're going to take care of a little business with the guy who can certainly share about the state of the league. More importantly, this franchise, the commissioner, Gary Bettman. It's a 3-2 ball, makes it a 3-2 game here in Brendan Byrne Arena after two periods of play. And I guess I'm having a little difficulty hearing myself, and we've got to say right off the bat, the commissioner, Gary Bettman, joins us. Gary, you're a lot braver than I am. These fans here are very upset because they believe that you are in favor of this franchise moving from New Jersey to Nashville. What is your position, Gary?
First of all, let there be no doubt that hockey fans are passionate. And here you hear it. The fact is, the Devils have some problems they're trying to work on. I haven't taken a position on the move because the Devils haven't made a decision. And it would be premature to do anything at this point. The Devils want to focus on what's taking place on the ice and not whether or not there's going to be a move.
Clearly, the fans here believe that you are in favor of a move here. But once that position has been clarified by the owner, Mr. McMullen, can the league do anything to tangibly affect the situation if it involves a move?
Well, we're going to be constructive in this situation. Whatever decision the Devils ultimately make, ultimately it's a decision that's made by the Board of Governors. And if they decide they have to move or they want to move, we'll deal with it in the ordinary course. But we haven't taken a position, and this is one of the areas where maybe the media hasn't been all that constructive.
Well, Gary, a year ago, the Cup was on Broadway, and Sports Illustrated had given a thumbs up to the National Hockey League, comparing the future of the NBA to the NHL. In your opinion, is the Sports Illustrated, are they right? Are they correct?
Well, I think last year the optimism was an outgrowth of the popularity of the game. We're working very hard to increase our fan base. We had a work stoppage at the beginning of the season. We got through it. Our fans came back strong. We're really grateful to them for it. Our problems are behind us, and our future is as bright as it's ever been.
And one other thought, you know, there's the discussion about the viewability of the trap when it comes to playing. And in marketing the future of this game, can the game afford to have the trap as part of its play?
You know, most of the general managers and coaches, and we had a general managers meeting today, don't think the trap is the issue. If there's an issue we have to address, it's interference, and we're going to study that over the next few weeks, and for next season, we're going to see if we can open up the game a little bit more.
We've only got about 15 seconds left, but Gary, what do you think a sports franchise's responsibility is to the community, especially with what we've seen with the Raiders moving again and that being the case around?
It's a two-way street, and the community and the business community and the building and the team and the fans all have to come together, and ideally you want the team to be an integral part of any community it's in.
You're a bold man to be here.
Great to be with you guys.
You be my blocky back. Gary Bettman, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
All right,
Thanks, guys.
Got a lot more coming your way here at the Brendan Byrne Arena. 20 minutes separate the New Jersey franchise from his first ever Stanley Cup. We'll find out if it happens after this.
The NHL on Fox, the Stanley Cup Finals, brought to you by Domino's Pizza. When it's got to be deep, it's got to be Domino's Ultimate Deep Dish Pizza. By Bud Ice, the official beer sponsor of the NHL. By Warner Brothers. Warner Brothers Under Siege 2 starts Friday, July 14th at a theater near you. And by the United States Army Reserve. Be all you can be. For more information, call 1-800-USA-ARMY.
Teams are back on. Courage and concentration is what it takes to play hockey. And it takes courage and concentration to be a commissioner in the midst of that mob across the way conducting an interview.
Yeah, you can understand the Devils fans and their feelings about this team possibly moving to Nashville, but they're misinformed, Mike. The ownership, led by John McMullen, who owns this team, along with the state of New Jersey, who's Governor Christine Whitman, and the Port Authority who run this building, they're the ones that have to make the agreement work. Nothing to do with the commissioner forcing a move. He's not. He's just trying to do the right thing. These are the people that have to get together and make a strong decision one way or the other. I felt that the commissioner showed some bravery just being there.
Before the start of the third period, Joe Micheletti downstairs. He had earlier talked with Ken Danico.
Ken Danico, we've played two periods. Now you go into the third period, a one-goal lead. What can we expect from your team in the third?
Well, we've got to continue to play like we did the second half of the second period. We got the puck in. We forechecked real well and had numerous opportunities. Unfortunately, not too many went in, but we're up one, and we're going to continue to work hard for the third.
You've been here for 13 years with New Jersey. It's been a long time. What are you thinking right now with one period to go?
Well, I'm just worried about that next shift. Jacques Lemaire has preached focus, and you win the battles against the guy you're playing against. That's all I'm concentrating on right now.
Thanks for your time.
All right, thanks. Appreciate it.
Our Bud Ice game summary. Broughton with two goals. Power play for New Jersey is 0-2, but it's underway once the period gets underway. The shots are 16-15 New Jersey. A lead after two in the playoffs. Pretty impressive for New Jersey. They've won 10 of 11. Power play begins with 1:08 showing on the clock at the start of this third. Niedermeyer and Driver will be the point man. Broughton working up front with Randy McKay and John McClain. Kozloff as well as Fedorov, the forwards for Detroit's penalty kill. In back, Rouse along with Coffey. Ahead comes Broughton, gets to McClain. Wedged off. McClain check, puck back to Niedermeyer. To Driver for a shot, it's turned aside by Vernon. Played now by Fedorov and lobbed all the way back down.
Not only turned aside by Mike Vernon, but he put the rebound into the corner. That's the goaltender's job, turn the rebound, the puck right into the corner.
Half a minute left on the power play. Niedermeyer could not go coast to coast this time. A pass in front is rustled loose by Airy, but kept by Stevens. Fires, and that blocked away by Bob Airy. Stevens again as the Devils come back over the line so that it can be an onside rush. A minute played in the third and 10 seconds left now on the power play. The Devils make another change in lines. Sergei Breland brings it on. Breland for New Jersey, trying to find an opening, pops it to the corner. Ramsey crosses with Guerin. Penalty time up. Ralston tried to center. Down to the ice he goes. Pulled it in with the glove, and play is stopped. Red Wings asking right away why there is no penalty call on that. But both teams are going to ask Bill McCreary about non-calls the rest of the night, because this is a one-goal game.
What an important grade this is for Scott Stevens, trying to win the Stanley Cup for the first time. Last season, his team was knocked out in a double overtime game against the New York Rangers, seventh game of the best of seven series. He, to this day, has never watched the tape of that game, refuses to. It's a bad memory. And ever since this team lost that game, they've been on a mission. Now, maybe, with 18:40 to go and his team ahead by one, he may be able to watch a lot of tape if his team wins the cup.
Indeed. And yet, after that disheartening loss to the Rangers, they didn't change a thing about what they do or how they went about it. They didn't even change the track. Guerin bumped off. Ralston turning with it. Cicerelli on him. And they hardly made changes in players.
The big addition of Neil Broughton, and he has two goals in this game, was the key change that this team made on the season.
Tisson puts it around behind. Turning with it is Chris Draper. Draper just lobs it back. Scott Stevens hands it over to Chambers. Both teams making a change again. Stevens lays it ahead. Follow up comes from Lemieux. Shakes one in. Richie after it. Richie carried off by Batiso. Bob Routes there. Flops it back down again. No icing on this, says Ray Scapinello, the linesman wearing number 29. Puck shot out of play at the timekeeper's table.
The puck was rolling down to the Devil's zone, and Kenny Danico tried to time it where he would touch the puck just after the puck went over the goal line. Instead, Ray Scapinello, the fine linesman, was right there on the play, waved it off. So Danico's timing was just off by a hair. He ended up taking the puck and firing it off the glass into the stands. Now Danico will chase the puck back. He can get there a little quicker if he needs to. So finally, the referee said no icing. Now he's going to take a hit, put the puck into the stands, and all of a sudden, from what he thought may have been icing and a face-off in the Detroit zone, it becomes a face-off in his own zone, and Detroit has a chance if they win the draw to get some offense.
We mentioned earlier that there are three guys who have played together on this team for a dozen years. That's the longest any threesome has been together on one team that's currently in operation in the NHL. McClain and Driver and Danico. They have been through some very lean years. fortunes of this franchise seemed to change in 1988 when they got to the seventh game of the third round before losing to Boston. Kozlov with a pass ahead. McCarty had it taken by Coffey. Back for Darren McCarty, checked off. And it's Danico hurrying it for Richie, but instead it's Fedorov. Round behind and Tommy Albelin to play. Albelin laid it just by Richie and Downer. He'd have had a clean cut breakaway.
He cut in behind where Paul Coffey had been. Coffey's freelancing. He's acting like a rover a little bit. He was deep in the zone. Fedorov had covered up, and then he moved in. That left it open, and it nearly worked for the breakaway.
The crash line is out for New Jersey.
Fedorov's down. Now he's up. He was banged by McKay, and he's hurting as he gets to the bench. Big collision just in the neutral zone, Mike, and Fedorov's hurting.
Play stopped here. Fedorov was hunched over as he coasted to the bench.
It's tough when you run into a wall. Randy McKay is the wall, and here's Fedorov. He sees him, and boom. Fedorov's had trouble with a bad shoulder. He went down, but he got up. He said, oh, I got to get to the bench, and he does. He may have been winded on the play, even though he has the bad shoulder. He did a lot of squats during the television timeout on the bench itself, and we'll see if he gets back for his next shift.
Big shot by Ramsey, and that one was wide. Lidstrom back to get it. Detroit trailing in the series 3-0. In the game, 3-2. Shots are 17-15 New Jersey overall. Low shot totals, but that's typical of a Devils game. Bet across now for Breland. Wedged off nicely by Ramsey. Yzerman for that one, banged it back off. Couldn't get it to Martin LaPointe. Tripled through, but the follow-up comes from Lidstrom. Then on to Krushelnicki. Detroit making a change in defense. Yzerman playing it ahead. Cicerelli worked one off of Breland's stick. Konstantinov was offside and play stopped.
Still seeing the good play by both teams within the rules that are the players are allowed to play with, the interference, the picking, the holding. With the commissioner, Mr. Bettman, on during the intermission, I thought the best news of the interview was during next preseason, they're going to look at that. And I think the referees will be busy during the preseason next season at calling the interference and the holding and the clutching and grabbing and the picking. And the game's going to open up. And if the game opens up at all, it's fast, it's exciting, there'll be more goal scoring, and the players will have to adapt to it. I'm looking forward to that already.
Yeah, I am too. You think about the notion of size and how a lot of teams, including perhaps Detroit over the summer, will add more size for next year. How is that going to be affected in terms of the size and also the fact that you're not going to be able to hold up an opponent that much anymore?
The only fear I would have is that if you can't interfere a little bit with a forechecking big forwards, the defenseman might get killed. The defenseman might get punished and punished and punished as they go back for the puck. But I think the league will adapt and make it important for the game itself and for the players not to be injured on the play. And the players will have to adapt. The players are smart. They will adapt if they're given enough penalties during especially the preseason.
This telecast presented by authority of the NHL, intended for the private use of our audience. Any publication, rebroadcast, other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of it, including the imposition of a charge for viewing the telecast without the express written consent of the NHL, is prohibited. Dave Maloney, James Brown, Joe Micheletti, away from our center ice location with John Davidson, Mike Emmerich. McKay shot it wide. They won a party to start from northern New Jersey tonight. Not yet. Oh, and that one spiked away from Richie. Detroit trailing by one. Richie really hit by Primo, and he went down. Right back up with it is Kozlov. Moving up with Cicerelli. Kozlov wiped out. Chambers turns it back the other way. A 3-on-2. Bobby Holík fires, and a save made by Vernon. Coffey dumped it back off. Holík moves to that one. Scott Stevens kept it alive. Rolling it around now for Richie. The Devils in the midst of a change, so he's all alone. And back up with it comes Sergei Fedorov. Big shot by him went off Danico. Stevens gave it on to Broughton. So Fedorov did not miss a shift, though it looked like he had been hurt by that hit from Randy McKay. Icing called against New Jersey. Play stopped. 3-2 Devils.
How strong is Stefan Richie? When Primo hits people, he explodes on them and knocks them down. This time Primo went down. Richie stayed on his feet as he was part of the crash line in place of Peluso on that shift. This kid, Keith Primo, quickly becoming a star in this league, has really put forth a gutty performance here in game 4
Lemieux couldn't start away with it. He just throws it back out. It is a collision sport. They often play four times a week, especially this year. You don't get this far without being physically spent and punished. Some way or other, you come up with adrenaline, and welts may not heal faster, but you don't pay as much attention to them at this time of year. 26 teams started it in January, and now we're down to these two.
And the Devils don't change their style. The fans can feel it. Look at the smiles. They can feel it. They saw it happen across the river last year. It's got to be nothing worse than an opponent that's a direct opponent getting it done. Ranger fans, I'm sure, aren't happy right now. It's like the Devil fans were not last season.
It is Driver weaving his way through center. Again, Vernon watches as it comes along near Doug Brown. Muscled behind for Bob Rouse. Kept by Driver. Shoots one that ricocheted to Lemieux. Lemieux to Carpenter. Pad, stop Vernon. Richer a shot, and that blocked by Coffey.
Richer getting double shifted, and that's a great vote of confidence by Jacques Lemaire, the head coach of the Devils. Richer getting a lot of ice time here. Vernon with another good save on the offside. And the fans respond once again. Jacques Lemaire has a philosophy. We want to force the man with the puck to make a play before he wants to. And that creates turnovers, it creates offense, it creates good defense. And his team lead 3-2 with 13:51 to go.
Isn't it marvelous how sports can unite a community? We saw that last weekend in Detroit, banners hanging all over the city. The city's talk is hockey. The region's talk here in the metropolitan area, particularly in northern New Jersey, is hockey right now.
Both teams have done a good job in blocking shots.
Ramsey again to Stu Grimson. Lapointe trying to get there but can't. Wedged by Niedermeyer. Rolled around by Alvaline. Chipped along by Mike Peluso. Hacked back in by Ramsey. And into the third row. Well, Detroit's system that they employed tonight and tonight only, how do you summarize it now that we've seen it for about 45 minutes or more?
Well, during the regular season, they had something called a left wing lock, where the centerman and the right wing would go in deep, Mike, and try and force things. The left winger would stay all the way back, almost up at the blue line, to help the defenseman if the other team came out with a puck. That hasn't worked against the Devils. They haven't been able to forecheck against the Devils. They haven't been able to get through and cause turnovers. So they decided to try and wait a little bit, be more patient. And so far, knowing it's a one-goal game, it's worked for them. They're in the game. Now time becomes their enemy more than anything else.
You may have heard a chant. It was, we want the cup, but coming in is Lapointe. Lost control, centered one that went off of Brodeur. Now Coffey a shot. Oh, and Brodeur got a piece of that one. Turnaround play, and it's blocked aside by Bobby Holy.
Right, Peluso went off, and the lane opened up over there, and all of a sudden it was a partial breakaway. That didn't work. Then Coffey had the chance, and Brodeur was there with a big one. A big save.
Grimson holding back McKay. Now Niedermeyer can rip it back in. Right on goal. And McKay seemed to be hurt, is headed to the bench now on a change. Maybe it was just his line coming off, but he was slow to get up and start to the bench after he'd been held down by Grimson. Angled back in. Big scoreboard clock above center ice, winking in time with the one you see in the upper left. Skipped along now for Ralston. Brian Ralston walking it ahead, and a drive is saved by Vernon. Breland came charging to the slot. Now it's Ralston again. Breland all alone in front.
A two-goal lead with 12:14 to go. This shot is stuck. But watch the Devils with their tenacity. That's one loose puck they've gotten to. Watch them continue to work the boards. There's another loose puck. Look at Breland in front. He got rid of his check. And he just turns and 360s the puck in past Mike Vernon. Shot and a save. And the Red Wings never recover. Loose pucks. And it's been Detroit trying to battle for them. And here, watch this play by Ralston into Breland. What a beautiful pass. And Breland had time to beat Mike Vernon. Vernon moves across. Breland, as you see, sweeps the puck inside the goalpost. 4-2, Detroit. And you can sense everywhere. They're starting to feel it. Larry Robinson with a two-goal lead. And this team is so good with a lead. They're saying Detroit has not registered a shot this period. They maybe think that Coffey missed the net on Brodeur. That great opportunity less than a minute before the Devils scored their fourth goal. Did Brodeur make the save? Coffey was in front. Here's the pass. It caroms out front. He may have missed the net, caught the outside of the goalpost. If that's true, Detroit has yet to register a shot in the period. There's 12:14 to go. New Jersey has the two-goal lead, and did they work for it?
A young man who played last year in Russia, last fall in Albany, New York, with another team that won a championship eventually, the farm team of New Jersey, the Albany River Rats. And now his first career playoff goal, Breland from Ralston and Bill Guerin at 7:46.
Not often in any sport do you see the major league team win a championship and the Devils are close and their farm club win the minor league championship. They did that in the American Hockey League under the tutelage and coaching of Robbie Fatorik, a former NHL player. This organization's deep, they're good, they're well coached, and they now enjoy a two-goal lead.
Lindstrom bumped it back off the boards. Kozlov took it there. Gives it back over to Nicholas Lindstrom through to Fedorov. Eyed up by Driver. Fedorov with a lot of stutter stops and starts. A pass is off Coffey. Lemieux brings it back. Watched by Lindstrom. He just angles it back in.
And he made sure he got the puck deep. Now the Devils can make a change. Smart play by Lemieux. Nothing fancy whatsoever.
That one flown by Coffey. No icing. Brodeur got help from Driver. Dumped along for John McClain. Then over for Chorsky and back down. Detroit trailing by two. New Jersey splendid on the road, particularly with two goal leads that are almost like threes or three and a halves. At home they are good too, but their record shows the dominance that they had on the road in these playoffs with record setting performance. Here they have the two goal lead. Detroit will see a lot of the trap. They'll try to break it with speed like that. Yzerman trying to get by, chopped it one, and it's scooped up by Brodeur. That's in games, 4-0. That's what they'd like to see. Right now, it's headed that way, but it's 4-2 on the scoreboard, the Devils ahead. That's been magical for them, that four spot. Konstantinov trying to shake loose, gives over to Yzerman. Nine-year captain of the Red Wings, hands it on now for Draper. Punched it around behind. The bear hug by Lapointe, the spin on Stevens, they can't clear. Lapointe stood up by Stevens again.
Got Konstantinov in. The defenseman for Detroit will be in on the offense as much as possible now, as they have to do anything and everything to try and score. Rodden took the last faceoff, and when New Jersey moved the puck out of the zone, he went right to the bench in favor of Breland. So Jacques Lemaire trying to do everything possible to be smart here and not make a mistake from the bench to give Detroit life or a chance to score. Now the crash line comes on to meet up with the big boys for Detroit. Krushelnicki, McCarty, and Grimson.
Well, you can see the fatigue, can't you? More adrenaline has to be drawn on as we head down the stretch of this one.
Larry Robinson really working over on the bench. Scott Stevens massaging his back, talking to him. Stevens has to be exhausted. He's played against all the best players throughout the playoffs and has been simply outstanding. And Larry Robinson, the coach of the defenseman, just working him, keeping him pumped.
Thrown back in by Bobby Holi. Set up by Vernon. Taken by Coffey. Bumped by Richey. Out in front. Backhander by Holi was blocked by Vernon. He's still down. Around behind, it's Richey again.
That's why Richey is getting double shifted here a number of times in the third period.
Bobby Holi once more. But this time, Mike Krushelnicki is up with it and starts it up for Detroit. Able to lay it off. Wants to get his own pass. Spun around. And then a freight train hit from behind by Grimson, and there'll be a penalty coming up. It'll be on Detroit. 9:36 to go in the third. The Devils will have a man advantage and two goals on the board.
The Detroit penalty.
Cicerelli tied up with Albelain. He missed with a wild slash, and then Grimson came in and just took a shot to the back of the head. You see knocking the helmet off. That's a silly penalty in this stage of the game with 9:36 to go. It just was absolutely unnecessary. Even if the Detroit Red Wings killed off this penalty to Grimson, it knocks 2 minutes off the clock. 9:36 to go, and Scotty Bowman's team is down by two.
Driver over to Niedermeyer. Bruce Driver again, and Niedermeyer once more. John pointed up the difficulty of that penalty because it takes 2 minutes off the time that Detroit desperately needs. Here's Bill Guerin moving along with it. Guerin shook it back in deep. Chopped at by Coffey, kicked at by Breland. McLean points it to the back. Driver loads the gun. Fires, deflected, and went by rebound. Shoveled into Vernon by John McLean.
Amazing how the backboards here act like a trampoline and just ricochet the puck right back in front. This morning, the Devils worked on their power play, and they did a lot of drills where they missed the net on purpose to get the puck out from behind the net in front to somebody open. There's McLean, does a good job getting the puck out high. The shot is deflected wide. McLean's just standing there waiting, and he had a stick on the ice. Vernon had to go down quickly. He cannot go out towards the man who's shooting the puck now, because look how quick the puck comes back off the backboards. So Vernon had to recover by getting himself down and stop the puck that was bouncing on McLean. The puck has jumped around a lot in this game. They have other events here, not only hockey. The Power Rangers, I think, were here yesterday. Detroit, one shot. And we're past the midpoint of the third period.
The scoreboard is not urging them on now. They're making a lot of racket that has just started as the Devils try their attack but failed. Kept alive now by Niedermeyer. Floated by Richey. Mike Ramsey there for Detroit's defense. Richey moving to it. Broughton crunched by Konstantinov. Played again by Broughton. Neil Broughton in some traffic. Clipped it into Konstantinov, and he cleared it out of play at the Detroit bench. So again, play stopped. 59 seconds still for Detroit to kill.
Detroit has one shorthanded goal in the game, but you can sense here that New Jersey has the two-goal lead looking for what's inside that trunk. And they're not going to take even chances on their power play. They're trying to play it wise, trying to play it smart. That's a beautiful thing there, Mike. That's a beautiful thing.
When you consider that you get your name on it, and it stays on it, unlike most trophies that are presented anywhere in any kind of athletic endeavor, your name is on there and it stays. One thing they did have to do a couple years ago was to remove one of the rings on it. That ring with a lot of names on it from the 30s and 40s is at the Hockey Hall of Fame. They just needed more room. They didn't want to make that trophy any taller. But it is impressive when it's wheeled out, and it's done with gloves on. New Jersey looking for the first time that they can get their names on that. And only two of the Devils have ever been on a Stanley Cup champion. Tisov throws a little bit of a scare into Detroit, but the pass went off Bob Airey. 28 seconds on the Devils' power play. Breland banks it back in, and it's Vernon. cranked around by Rouse. Kept by Chambers and pitched further. Bill Guerin rolls it along, taken by John McClain. McClain back to Chambers. Chambers waits, shovels one that's deflected wide by Guerin. McClain again and back to Chambers. Seven to go on the power play. Stevens nuffed one wide. Bill Guerin goes down. Freeland peels off with it. Sergei Freeland back to the point. Stevens fires, deflected in front. They jam away at it, and coming back with it is Breland. Penalty time is up. Thrown to the slot. Chambers and drive. Score!
Carbon copy. Second goal in the game by Chambers, both after a Devils power play had just expired. Chambers with a big shot. I mean, a rocket. Everybody for Detroit on one side of the ice. Chambers is wide open, and he has one terrific, heavy, hard shot. Vernon beaten high to the catching glove side, exactly where Chambers beat him before. It's a three-goal lead, five by the Devils, two by Detroit. And the Cup's going to be theirs. There's 7:28 to go. Detroit's only had one shot in the period. There's nothing there to say that Detroit will come back in this one.
Sean Chambers has family back in Detroit, and he has family in Florida. He was traded here by Tampa Bay just around the time that a young son was born. Because of the press of the schedule, he has only had the opportunity to see his newest about three times. Going to have quite a present to take down to him next time he sees him in Florida after this season's over. Scotty Bowman has been a part of a lot of championships. Chin extended. Still gamely coaching his team here with 7:28 to go. His team trailing one of his former players' teams by three.
Scotty coaching without a contract. I hope he'll be back. I hope he's back. If not with Detroit somewhere, he's an asset to the National Hockey League. Mike, in the first period, Detroit was great. They outshot the Devils early, 7-1. Since that point, the Devils have outshot Detroit 23-9. They've been just great defensively. They've gotten better as the game's moved along. And they now lead by three.
Chance taking time to the second power for Detroit now. They have 7 minutes left in which to get three. Darren McCarty. The official scoring of the goal, puck played by a high stick. Chambers from Breland and Guerin at 12:32. The Cup is ready. The champagne's chilled. Tonight's game produced by Richard Zients, directed by Sandy Grossman, studio produced by Scott Ackerson, directed by Artie Kepner, executive producers of Fox Sports, Ed Gorin and David Hill. Our associate director all season, Rich Russo, broadcast associate for the season, Eric Shanks, and our technical crew, wonderfully managed by Bob Muller. Here is Chorsky with a shot that is stopped off. Rebound, and Vernon had some help, and then it comes out in front. Holik to the back, Alvelina shot, that knockdown, turnaround by Chorsky is blocked. Cicerelli up with it for Detroit. Off a broken stick, it's taken by Chorsky and laid on back to Niedermeyer. Scott Niedermeyer, circle to circle. Alvelin to Holik, and it's pitched back. The lead is three. The time is dwindling. Rouse with a pass on to Cicerelli. Back to Rouse once more. Remarkable through all of this is that there have been such heavy rumors of the departure of this team over the last 2 months. You talk about having focus. Jacques Lemaire and Larry Robinson and all of these athletes, their commitment and their performance has not wavered at all, despite daily newspaper and broadcast reports about what's going to happen in their future, the future of their family.
Most businesslike team in the National Hockey League. Add skill level to it, great talent, well-coached team. It's a wonderful story at how well this hockey club has played throughout the playoffs. And you're absolutely right, Mike. Away from all the thought of moving, they've kept focused.
Breland across. Bill Guerin fires a scorcher wide.
It's a shot!
Jacques Lemaire and Larry Robinson were a part of the Canadiens team in the mid-70s. Down to the ice went Scott Stevens, and up with it is McCarty for a shot that's blocked down. And here's Bill Guerin trying to get by Coffey. Locks him up and up. Enough for help to come from Steve Yzerman, who can bring it back for Detroit. That was the last time that a team won the Stanley Cup Championship and the American League Championship, same organization. Until this year, if the Devils go on to win it. Albany claimed their title a month ago. It is Coffey. Hands it back on for Bob Errey. Across to Cicerelli. And cranked right back in. Driver once more. Matisse off with 4:20 now to go. Yzerman the steal. Yzerman in front. Left it behind. Couldn't get a shot away. Krushelnicki peels off to the corner. Around behind for Dino Cicerelli. Krushelnicki couldn't control. Gets it back again, though. The battle's still on.
New Jersey's playing the trap in front of their own goal now. Detroit's getting the puck, but they can't get it through. Five bodies plus the goaltender.
Krushelnicki with the shot wide.
Still only one shot in the period by Detroit. One. Not from the lack of effort. From the fact that the New Jersey Hockey Club is one great hockey club. They can talk about the trap all they want. This is a very talented hockey club with a group of defensemen that's not matched by any team in this league.
We will be continuing our coverage through the presentation of the Stanley Cup and the Conn Smythe Trophy. Will it go to Scott Stevens or that man, number 22, Claude Lemieux? Or will it go to Martin Brodeur? Every clearing toss down the ice brings a roar from this crowd. 19,040. The average in the playoffs and the average in the regular season up over 1,500 from last year. Held by Brodeur. And play is stopped.
You see the score, you see the time left, and you see a man by the name of Mike Peluso. Mike, you see him all season long. That's expressing what this means to him.
Tears of joy from the guy who put the crash into the crash line. And a lot of spirit into the dressing room. His family is here to watch him play tonight, coming from the range country up in Minnesota, where they're so proud of him. He was born in Hibbing, the same place as Bob Dylan and Kevin McHale. Those are the two most famous people. Well, by the end of the night, there'll be a third guy, and he'll have his name engraved on the Stanley Cup later. An emotional guy, and he's the first guy here every day for practice, every day for the games, Mike Peluso. And he'll be one of the last guys to leave tonight. This will be his longest and probably his happiest day ever in hockey.
You know, you're known as a scrapper and a fighter, and you wonder if you ever have a chance to play in the National Hockey League. He credits Mike Keenan for giving him a chance to play. You have to try to enjoy the moment. My goodness. It's just, that's what it means in this sport to be able to win it. You've got some people like Tom Troisky there with a smile. You've got Mike Peluso, can't control his emotions. And you've got Jacques Lemaire with 225. He's still coaching.
Constantino. On to Bob Errey and back in. The chant is the same one that began in the parking lot at about 1:30 this afternoon. Let's go Devils. Cicerelli with one that was deflected into the seats by Martin Brodeur, and again play stop. This year we've heard so much about lockouts and collective bargaining and hyperbaric chambers and left wing locks and neutral zone traps and boiled flying octopus. There was a great deal of uncertainty about this season, but then it came strong. From mid-January on, wonderful attendances in a number of towns, and I think the reason for that is the character of these guys. The heritage of this sport is rural Canada. The locker room, despite the adding of Europeans and Americans, is still rural Canada. It's look you in the eye, answer the question if you can, down to earth guys that people love.
The sport unites everyone, though. It really does. Broughton, our player of the game, he's made a commitment since he was delivered to the Devils. He's been staying in a hotel ever since he got here. That's months ago. His family was in Dallas at the time. They've had to sacrifice, and so has he. But it's worth it when you're in this position.
He's never won the Stanley Cup. 24 guys have played for the Devils, and 22 have never tasted this.
Mike, every player that dresses for the Devils in each game, they all play a major role. Some teams dress four lines of six defensemen, but the ice time is very different. Some people play a lot, others don't. Everybody plays for the Devils. Everybody's part of this team, and it's a lesson that can be spread around the National Hockey League.
Coffee with a shot that is blocked down by Bobby Holík in a three-on-two break. Holík moving in. Nearly got a shot away, and then McCabe fired one wide.
Peluso's line's on the ice. I wonder if he can't play because of his emotion level right now.
It would not be surprising.
No. Congratulations to the New Jersey Devils and their fans and their great staff. This is very well deserved.
In the Devils' locker room, a newspaper quote had the following passage underlined: "We have the heart of a champion. You cannot measure it. You can only feel it." A quote by Hakeem Olajuwon of the NBA champion Houston Rockets. Well, they're going to have a few quotes in the papers tomorrow.
Let's not forget about Detroit, their Red Wings, their coaching staff, and their great hockey city. They battled to get here for the first time in a long time, but they were beaten by a much better hockey club, much better hockey club.
The championship to New Jersey. The Devils win the Stanley Cup.
Celebration goes on,
and some guys who made the winged wheel proud in Detroit this year are in the line to shake hands with the Devils.
For Detroit, Paul Coffey leads his hockey club as they stop, and a lot of players are hugging the red jerseys and the white jerseys. And look at Peluso. He can't drop the arm from his face. He's crying. Fetisov, Scotty Stevens, teammates, even this season before Fetisov was traded. Scotty Niedermeyer will head back to Cranbrook, British Columbia, one of the most beautiful places on earth in the mountains, and just sit back and think about what he did.
Something like this comes back to you so often in your lifetime as you see Mike Peluso still brushing away the tears. This time passes so quickly, but yet it seems so long when you recount it years later.
He's Detroit's coaching staff, they too in line to shake hands. Look at that. We will have the Stanley Cup. John McLean. He's been the good, the bad, the ugly. The good is so wonderful. John McLean and Fetisov. Lou Lamoriello. Jacques Lemaire.
The stability came two falls ago with Lemaire and Robinson. Then a system, and then rejoicing. Let's check in downstairs.
Okay, here we are with Scott Stevens. You know, Scott, a year ago you were signed with St. Louis. You looked pretty happy to be going there. Here you are, standing captain of the Stanley Cup winning New Jersey Devils. How's it feel?
It's unbelievable. It hasn't sunk in yet. I can't believe it. These guys work so hard. It's unbelievable. Unfortunately, being on a great team.
Well, you know, you can talk about the steps up the ladder that this hockey club took to get here. Can you explain a little bit about what it took to get here for this franchise?
A lot of adversity, and we stuck it out. We believed in each other, and we played for each other, and that's why we won.
Now, you get a chance to go home now. You've been on the road. How happy are you to go home as a winner?
It was a big motivation factor. There's guys that are away from their families and kids that were just born. We want to win the game tonight, and we want to go home and enjoy ourselves.
Well, thanks an awful lot, Scott. Congratulations. We're going to throw it to Mike Emmerich up top.
Thanks a lot.
Good boy.
Earlier, Scott Stevens said in this playoff series, you have to have fun, or you'll be eaten alive by the pressure. The fun has begun. We'll be back with a Conn Smythe presentation, too, in just a moment. Sweep for the New Jersey Devils, and the moment is at hand for the presentations of the Stanley Cup, the dream of guys like Neil Broughton, who does have a gold medal from the 80 Olympics. They asked him how that would compare with the Stanley Cup, and he said, wait till I win it and then I'll tell you. Well, hopefully we'll hear from him before all this is done. They are bringing the Conn Smythe Trophy out now. That is awarded annually to the player judged to be most valuable to his team in the playoffs.
Last season, Brian Leetch of the New York Rangers won that award. Larry Robinson, the assistant coach with New Jersey, has won the award. It's a very special, special award to be your best player at the biggest time of the season. And nice to see Mike Peluso's caught himself.
Yeah.
Martin Brodeur, his father's on the ice. His dad's one of the photographers here in this game.
The Conn Smythe Trophy is awarded to the most It goes to Claude Lemieux.
Claude Lemieux started the playoffs against the Boston Bruins and knew his assignment was going to be going against a great player, Cam Neely. He said he had nightmares before the series started, just thinking about it. Now look at this, and is he appreciated by his teammates?
Claude Lemieux, one of the great characters of the game, one of the hated figures by opposition fans because he's pesky, and he has been a prolific scorer in these playoffs, and he gets the trophy now from the league commissioner, Gary Bettman, and shares it with the fans.
Maybe next year, coaches on other teams will have to worry about Lemieux instead of having Lemieux worry about the other players. He is a terrific big-time performer and has been all throughout his NHL career. Look at the tears and what it means to him. Oh, my goodness.
He has a brother back in Quebec. His brother has been limited since birth. He has dedicated a number of things in his life to his brother, who's very near him in age, and I'm sure this is one of them. Has another brother who played in the NHL for some time, too.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the Stanley Cup. The Devils' amazing playoff run has taken the term teamwork to a new level. Congratulations to the Devils. John McMullen, Lou Lamoriello, Jacques Lemaire, and the players. Scott Stevens, this is for you.
It goes to the captain, Then there are handoffs during a skate around the ice. We'll just let you watch and listen. John McClain, Bruce Driver, and Ken Danico, the three senior guys on the franchise who have been with an awful lot of the frustrating early years of this team, now are the first beyond the captain to get to raise it high.
Kenny Danico injured his knee earlier in the season. That's the main reason they made the trade to get Sean Chambers. They thought he was done for the season. Danico defied the odds, made it back, and was significant in helping his team become the champions they are.
Children playing a children's game. Randy McKay almost fell with it. The interesting thing, while some of these guys have been holding it up, others have been jumping up and down and hugging like 7, 8, 9-year-old mites.
It's a playoff stretch that sometimes lasts 2 months of battles and wars and battles and wars. And this is the result. It's not about money. It's about championships. It's about team play. And he is like the father to this club. And I think he's enjoying just sitting and watching his team celebrate, as he once was a player doing the same thing, talking about head coach Jacques Lemaire. You know, Bobby Carpenter's in there. He was holding the cup up. It wasn't long ago Bobby Carpenter was playing with the Boston Bruins and fell into the boards and shattered his kneecap and wasn't sure if he'd have a future in hockey. He now has a championship.
Dave Maloney has the Conn Smythe winner alongside. Dave.
Well, here we are with the Conn Smythe winners. Mike Emery suggests, Claude, you've been a big game player your whole career. I want to tell you, this has been a big run for you. Does it get any better than that?
Well, you know, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for my teammates. I can't believe that I won the Conn Smythe trophy, but, you know, I played well, but the guys played unbelievable, and the guys that came up big for us tonight, what an incredible feeling. Chambers, Broughton, you know, Brillen. This is what our team is all about, and it's just an incredible feeling.
Well, can you compare, you know, you won a cup with Montreal. Can you compare these two wins at all?
This is so different. I can appreciate every moment of it, because in 86, it was like a dream came true that it happened so fast. And now I'm going to enjoy this one. It took me 9 years to get it back.
Can you speak a little bit about the significance of Jacques Lemaire?
You know, New Jersey Devil, Jacques Lemaire, you know, that's what it's all about. The minute that he came here, this team was a new team. And we believe in him, we believe in his system. And we got a cup for him, and I think he'll be the happiest man ever.
Well, congratulations, enjoy your offseason.
Thank
Thanks for coming. We're going back to Mike Emmerich.
Thank you.
David, thank you very much. Some more carrying of the cup, and now taking it over near the glass where some of the fans can see it better. And a tribute to the New Jersey fans. So often there have been cases where fans have wound up going onto the ice in situations like this. This is a player's moment. And congratulations to those fans. They've recognized it as that. They're enjoying it too, but they're staying away from this special moment for the players. Joe Micheletti is downstairs with Detroit coach Scotty Bowman.
Scotty, you had a heck of a year, but you came up a little short. What happened in the finals?
Well, I think we got behind. You know, we lost a couple of real tough games at home, and then we really ran into a team that was at the top of their game. They're a big, strong team. They really know how to play good defense, and when you do that, you're going to win a lot of games, and they won a championship, and they deserved it.
Your contract expired in June. Can we expect you to be coaching next year?
Yeah, I wouldn't have a problem working out a contract with the Detroit Red Wings. I just said all along that I would sit down after the season. you know, there are some priorities to check with my family, my health, and make sure that everything's okay. But I enjoyed the year. Our team really put out. You know, we got close to the top, but we didn't get to the top.
Scotty, thanks for your time. Mike, let's go back up to Sarah to you.
On a night that was not good news for Detroit, Scotty Bowman's return and willingness to work something out, hopefully, is good news for Detroit. The celebration goes on. Jacques Lemaire holding the cup that his team won tonight. James Brown after this.
So the Stanley Cup has been awarded for the 125th time since 1893. And the name etched on 1995's version, the New Jersey Devils. And folks, for the 17th time, there has been a sweep in the NHL Finals since 1939, when the format was shifted to a seven-game format. And folks, I tell you, it has been an outstanding run for the New Jersey Devils, and we certainly congratulate them. Tonight's broadcast also signals the end of our first season of NHL telecast here on Fox. And for those of us at Fox Sports, the start of this partnership was marked by the enthusiasm of bringing an exciting and fast-paced sport to a wider audience with a Fox touch. And I can certainly tell you on a personal note that from the perspective of a hockey neophyte, the NHL and its players have been as accessible and helpful as any group I've ever met. And if the continued growth of this sport is reflected in other areas, folks, the future will be bright. We'd also like to thank the Canadian Broadcasting Company for invaluable assistance provided to us here at Fox throughout the year. So for Joe Micheletti, John Davison, Mike Emmerich, my partner Dave Maloney, and all of us here at Fox Sports, folks, we will see you next season on the ice. And don't forget that the next time we'll come your way, it'll be on August the 12th when the NFL on Fox returns Dallas and Buffalo from Toronto. I'm James Brown. Good night from New Jersey. Thank you.